Assalamu alaikum, everybody. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi wa salatu wa salam ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursalina Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim tasliman kathira. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Rabbi awzi'ni an ashkura ni'mataka allati an'amta 'alayya wa 'ala walidayya wa na'mala salihan tardah wa aslih li fi dhurriyyati inni tubtu ilayka wa inni min al-muslimin. I'm sorry, this gathering was supposed to take place yesterday, but Allah plans, and He's the best of planners. I was supposed not to be here yesterday. I was supposed to be in Sudan, but it happened that I'm here. So already that time was booked up by something else yesterday, and for this reason we made it Salaam Monday, alhamdulillah. And the topic that I chose this time to speak about, I think in this day and age, very important, is how can we remove this dilemma, this fear, this worry that encompasses our life and hold onto our hearts regarding sustaining ourselves, regarding achieving that which will make us live a life with dignity and honor. It is tough for somebody to live their life while they are unable to understand and appreciate that Allah is the one who is responsible for the sustenance. How can we make it easier for ourselves? This is a question, inshallah, we're going to look for to answer. And when we're in debt, how should we behave and how should we look after ourselves in that sense? This is nothing to do with Muslims or non-Muslims, believers or non-believers, people of faith or not faith. No. This is for every human being. Risk concerns every human being. As far as I know, there is no human being in this world who will not be worried about their risk. No human. Every human being worries about their risk. And in the Quran, Allah speaks about risk. And one of His names is Al-Razzaq, the sustainer. But there are other names linked to this name when it comes to your sustenance. There is Al-Wahhab, the giver, and there is also the one that who increases your rizq or your hiba, your sustenance or your gifts, and that is Al-Basit. I remember vividly I was sitting in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in 1981, if I am not mistaken. The year I think Prince Charles got married. Because when I came back, the whole thing was different. And the country was in celebration. I was sitting in the Rawda, and this young boy, maybe late teens, early 20s, dressed beautifully, came and sat next to me, and he started talking to me. A little I got to know that the master who taught this young boy lived next door to where my family lives in Sudan. And he whispered in my ear something I will never forget, and I will never stop praying for him in regard of this name Al-Basit. Absolutely beautiful and significant for the person who is seeking that Allah will make it easier for them to achieve the sustenance. But before we come to that or these things, I want everybody to realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who is responsible for your sustenance, nobody else. The employer who employs you is not responsible for your sustenance. Your parents are not responsible for your sustenance. The ultimate responsibility is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here, we need to have strong faith. In the Quran, in Surah Ar-Rum, Surah number 30, verse 40, Allah said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, الله الذي خلقكم. Allah, it is He who have created you. ثم رزقكم. Then, He apportioned for you your sustenance for the duration that you live on this earth. ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ. Then He will take you by death. ثُمَّ يُحِيكُمْ. Then He will bring you forth into life in the day of resurrection. Now from this verse, as if Allah to say, because I created you, because I made you, it is my responsibility to sustain you. So rizq is not for the believer. Rizq is not for the one who practices within the religion. Rizq is not for the one who will be devoted in continuously remembering Allah. No, no. The kafir is given rizq. The animals are given rizq. Any creature Allah creates, it is His responsibility to sustain. And from this verse, we learn this. In Surah Al-Nahl, Surah number 16, verse 71. وَاللَّهُ فَضَّلَ بَعْضَكُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ فِي الرِّزْقِ. And Allah has favored some of you over others when it comes to sustenance. Because somebody could ask, why does he have or she have and I don't have? Why are they richer and we are poorer? A lot of the younger generation today who are not really holding into religion properly and turning into ways of achieving extra sustenance through haram ways by selling drugs or al-iyadu billah, even selling them their own souls, doing evil things, they look at the others who are not believing in Allah, those who are not practicing within the faith, and they have a lot, and they say, look, they don't even believe and they have. They don't even practice and they have. And sometimes they say it loudly. I do everything, but I'm getting nothing. Are you doing what you are doing because you want to be repaid in material, monetary funds? Are you praying extra for extra? No. You can't repay Allah for what He has given you. He has a portion to risk. You must be assured. He made some have more and some have less for a reason. And we will come to that reason in a minute. In Surah Al-Isra, Surah number 17, verse 30, Allah says, Inna Rabbaka yabsutu rizqa liman yasha. The name Basit. Indeed, your Lord will increase the sustenance to those whom He wished to increase for them. وَيَقْدِرُ. And for others, He make less. He restrain the amount they receive. Why? إِنَّهُ كَانَ بِعِبَادِهِ خَبِيرًا بَصِيرًا. For it is He, Allah, who is most aware, knowledgeable about His servant and understand the requirements that will make them turn to Him. As if Allah is saying, look, I created you, and according to my knowledge, I'm going to give you. I'm aware of where you need and where you don't need. I'm aware if I give you more or give you less. So if you are really a believer, a true believer, then you realize if you have less, if life is tough, there is a reason. Allah is trying to pull you towards Him. Have you ever seen somebody praying hard when they are no, or when they are in a position where there is no need? When people are in need, they pray hard. The harder the life, they pray harder. Before the exam, you pray hard. After the exam, nobody prays. That's the reality. Everybody before the exam, they are crying hard, please. People ring me from abroad, from my own family in Sudan. They have got mashayikh next to them. They ring me, Sheikh, please pray for me. And they're praying themselves and they're good. So Allah sometimes, when He restrains that door of rizq, because He wants you to turn to Him. Don't neglect Him, for it is indeed Him who created you to know Him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Ankabut, the spider, Surah number 29, verse number 17. فَابْتَقُوا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الرِّزْقِ. Do seek your sustenance from Allah. وَعْبُدُوهُ وَشْكُرُوا لَهُ. And do worship Him and show gratitude. Allah is beginning to tell us, okay, seek your sustenance by asking Allah. Ask Allah to make it easy. Ask Allah, how should I achieve it? Make istikhara. Consult Allah, is this the right way to achieve it or not? Don't just jump into it. You could earn your sustenance through a halal way. You could earn it through haram. You could work hard and sweat and earn it. You can go and steal it. You can go and invest it. You can go and gamble it. For shaitan, two different ways. One way that will lead you to Allah, and one way that will put you and distance you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sidi, move here. So I come this way. Because there are some sisters here from here. So this is something that we need to take seriously. There is places in the front if the sister wants to come to the front. Okay? It is important. Okay? So seek from Allah alone by asking Him. Wa'budu. And worship Him. And I always tend to tell people, here Allah is not telling you just fast more or pray more. No. Allah is telling you through this verse, get to know Him. As Ibn Abbas says, ibadah is to know Allah. Who Allah is. And then you will understand what He wants in this aspect. Washkuru lah. And show shukr. I always remind people, there is a big difference between hamd and shukr. Hamd is thanks, and shukr is showing by giving in means. So when you say alhamdulillah, that is enough. Allah begins the Quran by saying, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. There are four surahs begin with alhamd. If you don't know them, get to know them and read them. And beautiful. Fatiha, al-an'am, Saba, and Fatir. Beautiful. I read always those verses because hamd will bring you a lot from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what will bring you more is gratitude. Gratitude is when Allah gives you, gives from what Allah gave you. If Allah gave you intellect, share that intellect with others. Don't use it only to gain for yourself. Volunteer, okay? Whatever Allah has provided for you, in means of teaching, in means of supporting and helping, good. And if you have the means to give from what Allah gave to you. Okay, and this we will make clearer later on. In Surah Ash-Shura, Surah number 42, verse 27, Allah said, وَلَوْ بَسَطَ اللَّهُ الرِّزْقَ لِعِبَادِهِ لَبَغُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. And if Allah is to expand sustenance for His servants, they will indulge in doing a lot of evil on this earth. And this is the reality. When you have more, you tend to do more of that which Allah dislikes. You become extravagant. You become a waster. You waste. Haven't you seen people who have a lot of money? They go to a restaurant. They buy a meal. Maybe it costs 100, 200. Do you know that you can go and have a meal for 15,000 pounds? Do you know that? You can go and have a lunch or dinner for 15,000 pounds? In London.
Selfridge, 10,000, a little mobile telephone.
No, I'm talking about a meal. You go to a restaurant, you order a meal, 15,000 pounds. And here there is somebody struggling to earn 15,000 pounds all day. But this person, he might order it, test it, I don't feel like it. At least it doesn't matter. But you might think, oh, this is terrible. But we who have less, we go to with the grill. We pay 7 pounds. We don't like it, we leave it alone. The same thing. Some people come to say, oh, these Arabs, when they come here, we go to Edge Road, they leave their meal in the plate. When you go to their houses, they cook a lot of food, they throw it in the bin. We do the same thing. Whether you have less or you have more, when you throw it, you don't realize there is somebody less fortunate than yourself who needs what you have thrown away. There are people picking from the bins. I traveled and I have seen with my own eyes. I wish you traveled. Put a rack on your back or a sack on your back. Travel. Walk around India, Africa, South America. You will see children eating from the bins. Then every time one grain of rice falls, you will pick it and eat it. If your food falls on the floor, you don't say, dirty, throw it away. You will eat it. Because you realize this is ni'mah Allah has provided for you and you should not. So Allah is telling us, the more we receive, the more neglectful we are of him, and the more oppressive to ourselves by being excessive in what we do, we waste a lot. Allah said, we don't want that. So we restrain your rizq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Dhariyat, this surah is so beautiful. I encourage everybody to read it. If you have never read it, it is one of the most beautiful surahs. It speaks a lot about rizq. It's the only surah that speaks a lot about rizq. Surah number 51 in the Quran. And I picked verses 56 to 58. In which Allah said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created the jinn nor the humans only to get to know me. مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ رِزْقِ. I don't want them to provide for me. All of us, you know, when we learn and we get qualifications, we don't want to give from our knowledge, from our know-how to anybody without receiving money. Okay, you want me to do this? How much will you pay me? Allah said, I created you to know me and I'm giving you everything, but I don't want you to sustain me. I don't want you. All the prophets, they never take reward for what they do. وَمَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَجْرِ. I don't ask you to pay me for teaching you. I don't want it. This is the idea of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَن يُضْعِمُونَ. And I don't want the human nor the jinn to feed me. Allah cannot be fed. Allah does not eat or drink. So the sustenance is for you to benefit yourself so that you can get some energy and strength while you are living on this earth to spend your time striving to get to know who your Lord is, who Allah is. That's the whole idea about إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. Indeed Allah, it is He the sustainer, the most powerful, the strong. He sustains everything. Believe me, we humans, we plot, we plan, we do everything. Brothers, can we move forward? We do everything, but yet we are unable to look after ourselves properly. But Allah does. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through His power, He is able to sustain everything that we know and everything that we don't know. There are creatures we know and there are creatures we don't know. Allah sustain them and look after them because He created them, as we said earlier on. In Surah Al-Ankabut, Surah number 29, verse number 17, Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ. Allah is addressing the non-believers. Indeed, those you worship beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَا يَمْلِكُونَ لَكُمْ رِزْقًا. They do not possess any sustenance for you. You can't turn to other than Allah and ask them for sustenance. Never. Even somebody who employs you. I don't turn them for my rizq. I turn to Allah. But they require a service. If Allah provide for me the energy, the knowledge to provide it, I will do it because He will provide for him to provide for me. But He's not my provider. Allah is my provider. I was told earlier on, in regard of this, a beautiful statement from somebody I love very much. لا تخفل بابا الله قد فتحه لك. لا تخفل بابا الله قد فتحه لك. Do not close the door Allah has opened for you. So you are in a job. Don't say, I'm bored with this job. And you leave it. Stay and stick and do your work, because maybe that's the only means or the only way, Umar and the brother come, you can sustain your sustenance. You can get your rizq. Do not shut a door Allah opened for you. This is something I tell you. لا تخفل بابا الله قد فتحه لك. ولو فتح الله لك ولو قفل الله لك بابا فتحت لك أبوابا. If Allah closed the door for you, many doors will open. So if suddenly anything you are striving to do is closed before you, لا تضجر. Don't be frustrated and upset and angry and frightened and worried. What for? Don't pull your hair. Don't rip your clothes. Don't hit the wall. Don't kick things. Don't swear. Don't question Allah. Why me? Why this happened to me? Don't do that. For Allah knows one door when it is closed without your own permission to be closed, Allah will open many doors. Allah is my witness. I had a successful, beautiful business in this city, London. When I graduated and I got married and I realized I have to be responsible now. My family was responsible for me. I should be responsible for myself. So I opened myself an office in the city. 3 months down the road, Allah has opened for me a bigger. So I opened a shop in Oxford Street. I used to sell a lot of money. And when property was cheap, the money I used to sell, in one day I could buy a property every day. And one day I saw, after almost 1 year, everything is going well. The Sheikh in my dream coming saying to me, close it. When I said, I'm going to close it, everybody who knows me said, are you crazy? Are you mad? Why should you close it? I said, Allah is ordering me to close it. I'm going to close it. I closed it. I did not even worry where my risk will come from next. I traveled to my country. I came back. The day I arrived, I put my bag like this. The telephone rang. We need you. What for? We have a job for you. I didn't even apply for a job. So when you don't worry about that side of it, Allah will take care of it. When you don't question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about what He promised to do for you, as long as you do what you promised to do for Him, He will look after. He doesn't break His promises. Do what Allah commanded you to do, and Allah will take care of what He promised to do on your behalf. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Dhariyat again, Surah 51, verses 22 and 23. وَفِي السَّمَاءِ رِزْقَكُمْ وَمَا تُوَعَدُونَ. And in the heavens is your sustenance and whatever you have been promised. فَوَرَبِّ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِنَّهُ لَحَقْ مِثْلَ مَا أَنَّكُمْ تَنْطِقُونَ. By the Lord of the heaven and the earth, Allah is making an oath to us. Why does Allah have to make an oath for us? Don't we trust Him? Don't we believe in Him? They say in Mecca there was a nomad. Subhanallah. This nomad, Allahu Akbar. This nomad is making tawaf. And suddenly, he heard a man reciting these verses. When it came to wal rabbi as-samaa'i wal ard innahu lahaq mithla ma annakum tattaqun, he just screamed, why does my Lord have to make an oath for us? We are the created and He's the creator. And he just breathed loudly and he fell down dead, because he couldn't believe. Why should Allah, just like your father in the morning saying to you, look, wallahi, I'm going to buy you dinner tonight, don't worry. It doesn't have to. Your mother say, wallahi, I'm going to cook your food tonight, don't worry about it. Why should your mother make an oath for you to cook or not to cook? She's going to do it because she's your mother. Your father is going to strive to earn living because he's your father. This is his responsibility towards you. So this is here what Allah is telling us. Your sustenance is with Him. And everything He promised you for this world or the hereafter is with Him. And if you don't believe Him, He's making an oath. By the heaven and the earth, this is the truth, as you speak. In Surah Hud, verse 6, this is Surah number 11, to make us understand, it's not just us who are receiving this sustenance. Everything. وَمَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ رِزْقُهَا. There is no creature on this earth, crawling, walking, flying, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sustaining them. All the creatures in the sea, or on the land, or on the air, wherever they might be, we know them or we're not, Allah is sustaining them. In Surah Al-Dhariyat, Surah number 51 again, verse 58, Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهُ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةُ الْمَتِينَ. Indeed, Allah is the one who sustains. So when you need to think about your sustenance, always put in your mind, إِنَّ اللَّهُ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ. Allah is the sustainer. Allah will sustain me. Nobody else. I just need to do my job. If there is no work to do, I need to strive to find work. If I find the work, I need to be diligent, to be honest, to be truthful, to be steadfast, to be punctual and do my job. Many of us don't do these things. Even if we don't have a job, we tend to be claiming to be sick and we're not sick. We're doing something and then we get there late and we make an excuse of the traffic. This is lying. It's not Islam. We should be exemplars when it comes to this kind of things. In Surah Al-Hajj, Surah number 22, verse 58, Allah says, وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَهُوَ خَيْرُ الرَّازِقِينَ. Indeed, Allah is the best of the providers. The best. خَيْرُ الرَّازِقِينَ. هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ خَيْرُ الرَّازِقِينَ. I always make dua and I say, Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, Ya Arham al-Rahimin. Ya Allah, Ya Razzaq, Ya خَيْرُ الرَّازِقِينَ. Because one of his name is خَيْرُ الرَّازِقِينَ. Not just Razzaq, but the best of those who sustains is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here, I will conclude by saying, لا بد لنا أن نسعى من أجل الحلال الطيب وأن نبتعد من الحرام غير الطيب. It is a must that we strive to achieve our sustenance through halal ways. And when we buy things to wear, to live in, to eat or drink, or to use in our life generally from the resources we need, they must be good. Not just lawful, good. Don't buy something rotten. Don't buy something bad that will cause you problems. Today we see in the world, a lot of shops are making a lot of money because they are not just selling us the halal, but there is the halal and the good one. So that means that is not good. That's not healthy. Buy the healthy food. It's not just for joke. This is reality. Buy something good. Don't buy something rotten. Don't go and buy things that people want to throw away. Buy that which will please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah says, halal wa tayyib. Not just halal, halal and good in the meantime. Allah says about this in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Surah 5, number, verse number 88. وَكُلُّ مِمَّا رَزَقَكُمُ اللَّهُ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا. And do eat from what Allah has provided for you, that which is halal, lawful and good. طيب meaning good. But many of us, when we look at the means of sustaining ourselves and we strive and we work and we earn, there are only two things we think about. What can I use to better myself? Whether I eat, drink, wear, gadgets, whatever, live, drive a car. You want to have the best for yourself. And what can I invest? There is a third element to this. Yes, do that. But what can you spend for Allah or on behalf of Allah? Allah said in the Quran, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, in Surah Al-Munafiqun, Surah number 63, the hypocrites, verse number 10. أنفقوا مما رزقناكم. We're going to sustain you. It is upon us to sustain you, O children of Adam. But do spend and share from what we have provided for you. من قبل أن يأتي أحدكم الموت. Before one of you is ready to die. It is so sad for a human being who did not spend from what Allah has given to them. When you are lying there dying, it will become the most terrible thing for you. And then you will say, Arji'un, return me back. You know what you will say to the malaika when they say, why should we return you back? To do what? فَأَصَّدَّقَ. So that I can give him charity. وَأَكُمْ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. And I become one of those grateful. Everything Allah gave to me, I'm going to share now. But it's finished. Just like one person did the exam is finished. And he came back and said, what do you want? Can I have my paper back? What for? I want to do better. I want to get that distinction. Distinction? It's done. رفع القلم وجفت الصحف. The pen has been taken away and the ink is dry. Once you are there and the soul reaches the throat, there is no return. The malaika who are working to get your soul out and Israel are so happy. Enough, you have done damage on this earth. Return back. Please, you have three dimensions regarding your risk, and one of them is so important. Of course, yourself, okay? And that which you are responsible for, from your family, but then others. whom you are not related to, whom you don't know, and they need from what Allah has given to you. I feel so glad when I look at people who are very charitable. I remember once I was watching television, they brought this old pensioner, an Englishman. There was a drought in East Africa, and he went to the bank and drawn all his savings, and he gave it in charity. They asked him, but what are you living for yourself? He said, they are dying for goodness sake. And you are asking me what I'm living for? I have something to eat and drink. This is just saving. I'm not using it. I don't need it. Do we as Muslims or believers or people of faith think like that?
No.
We don't. No, we don't. And this is why sometimes I question myself whether our faith is true or not, because we need to be genuine. Allah said, do not give everything you have and then depend upon others to look after you, but nor hold your hand tight to your neck and become a very stingy person. Always share from what Allah has given to you, because Allah is going to give you more. Surah Al-An'am, verse 151, surah number 6, Allah tells us something else that we worry about. We're living in a world today, many of us, not maybe deliberately, but without realizing, they are killing their children because they are fearing poverty. So what is happening? The wife will come and say, I'm pregnant now. And the man is panicking. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. We can't cope. We have no money to look after another child. Get rid of it. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. This person has no iman because he thinks he is providing. Allah, nobody. We, in Sudan, we say in the Arabic slang, ما شق الله حنك ان ضيع. Allah never opened a mouth and neglected. Once Allah created a creation, He sustains it. Not like us. How many men living in Britain here, we hear about them, they get girlfriends or married a woman and have children and they run away. How can you run away? This is your children. We men are responsible for the children, not their mothers. So that association or organization that run after parents to provide, I'm with them. They should provide for those children. You can't have children and then run away and not provide for them. You are the father, and the father is responsible for his children. You see, not the mother is responsible for the child. The mother is responsible for caring and looking after and giving that love. But the father is providing for that child because he's a child. Allah says, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ Surah Al-An'am, Surah number 6, verse 151. Do not kill your children min imlaq, out of fear. نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكُمْ وَيَّهُمْ We will provide for you and them. You know, sometimes your life is controlled and your rizq is not coming in abundance. But once you get married, more rizq comes. You say, wow, my life is changed. Once you have a child, more rizq comes. This is what happened to all of us. You have your own rizq, but then when you get a wife, her rizq will come. When you have a child, his rizq will come. And some people don't realize, maybe one of your children, Allah is going to give them an abundance. Yeah. And then you are going to be lucky. Many parents live from the earning of their children. How many stars in the world, they have nothing, living a life of poverty, and suddenly their children become billionaires. And the parents are enjoying not their own, but their children. Without that child, they will not have this risk. You see, so this is something to think about. And Allah says in Surah At-Talaq, the divorce, Surah number 65, verse number 3, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا And whosoever fear Allah, Allah will give them a way out of their difficulty. وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ And provide for them from a space or a place that they had never thought of. Never worry. If there is a couple who are married and suddenly it become difficult and it came to divorce, they should divorce amicably. But today, the rich, the famous, and the poor, when it comes to divorce, they fight for the last penny. Read Surah At-Talaq. Islam is so beautiful. Allah says, don't worry about your rizq. Because at the end of the day, if you are fighting over who will have what about the children? And therefore, you find a lot of the women, when it comes to divorce, they use their children as a means of negotiation. You're not going to see them. And the father is panicking. Exactly. I have to see them. No, you're not going to see them. Over my dead body, you see your children. That is wrong. The father have a right to see his children, but it is wrong from him not to provide for them once the separation takes place and to give her her right. You can't have it all. Now you have the children and have everything. It's a matter of sharing. There is a responsibility Allah gave in the Quran. What did the Messenger say about rizq? قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن من عبادي لمن لا يصلح إلا الفقر. Indeed, some of my servants, nothing will benefit them only when we reduce their rizq, make it less. ولو أغنيته لأفسدت عليه دينه. But if I sustain them with extra and give them more, I will spoil their faith for them. People, I think, come on. How could this happen? I'm all right. I'm a very good believer. I'm a strong. If Allah gives me more, I'm not going to be ruined. I promise you by Allah. I have seen many people. They were steadfast in the mosque. They were in the front line. They were rushing regularly. They were always doing the right thing. The moment they are busy earning, they are not doing it anymore. When you ask them, oh, life is tough. What do you mean life is tough? Every day you are in the masjid. Now because you have got more money, you don't come to the masjid. But you find there are rich people, they are always in the masjid. Because Allah knows, He gave them, they will do it. Allah did not give you because He knows, once He gives you, you are going to run away. So here, Rasulullah ﷺ is telling us, Allah said in the Hadith al-Qudsi, there are those whom I restrain and reduce their sustenance, because if I give them in abundance or give them more, I will spoil their faith for them. Okay? And vice versa. وَإِنَّ مِنْ عِبَادِي لِمَنْ لَا يَصْلُحُ إِلَّا الْغِنَى. Some of my servants, nothing will make them better. Only if I give them more. وَلَوْ أَفْغَرْتَهُ لَأَفْسَدْتَ عَلَيْهِ دِينَهُ. And if I reduce their sustenance, I will spoil their faith for them. And this is true. Some people enjoy giving. I know some brothers, they can't stop giving. Wallahi, Allah is my witness. I used to have a cousin of mine. When I used to go and visit Sudan and see him, I used to be proud of him. He will be coming out of his house in the morning and there will be a queue, a mile. And he will sit in his Range Rover and he will open a bag in front of him and the window is open and the queue will come and take. I don't know how much money he has, $50,000, $100,000, and he just gives. And I noticed one thing that made me think. Sometimes there is somebody in the queue, he said, you, stand away. I felt sad. Why are you speaking on these people, taking them or not giving them? Without me asking the question, just whispering to show that how good he is, after he arrived and we are going away to his office, he would tell me, you know, Sheikh, those I took out, I give them a regular salary. But they are greedy. They come and queue again. I don't want them to be greedy. The hand that gives is better than that that receives. I know their need, so I give them a salary. Because they have children or they have somebody ill at home. Allahu Akbar. When he died, in his janazah, there were too many people there. And people were asking, who are you? We were the people whom this man used to sustain. So I said to his children, they were young at the time, just in university, colleges, you have a big responsibility. Whatever your father left for you, you need to carry that. And the second younger son said to him, he was about maybe in his teenage. He used to go and pray with me, and he said to me, Allah, Sheikh, you said something special. Because I really feel my father was special by doing this. And Allah gave him this responsibility. But now leaving all those things and those people, we must look after. Very, very important. If your father was rich, your brother, your family, and leave anything, you should give it. In another hadith reported by Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah, قال رسول الله سلم, the messenger, peace be upon him, says, قال رب العزة تعالى. The Lord Almighty said in a hadith Qudsi, يبنى آدم تفرغ لعبادتي. O son of Adam, be always busy with my worship. أَمْلَأْ صَدْرَكَ غِنًا وَأَسُدُّ فَقْرَكَ. I will give you content within your heart. I will fill your heart with contentment and I will remove your poverty. وَإِلَّا تَفْعَلْ. And I warn you, if you don't do that, مَلَأْتُ صَدْرَكَ شُغْلًا. I will fill your heart with worries, anxiety, maybe fear, and even maybe depression. Well, asudda faqrak, and I will not take away poverty. I'll keep you in that position. So this is from the point of view of the Quran, the rizq and where it comes from, and our duty towards it. It is from Allah. We should not worry. We should not fear. We should always realize whatever we receive is what is written for us. We need to strive to achieve that which is halal, that which is good. We need to realize that we should share it with those who have not. We need to make sure that at the end of the day, those whom we are responsible for, we should depend over them. How can we make it easy? That is where the lesson is. How can we make this easy for ourselves? Number one, to make your rizq easier to achieve an increased, giving charity. Allah said in the Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah number 2, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ حَبَّةٍ أَنْبَتَ السَّبْعَ سَنَابِلِ فِي كُلُّ سُنْبُلَةٍ مِئَةَ حَبَّةٍ وَاللَّهُ يُضَاعِفُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. The example of those people who give from what we have given to them for the sake of Allah, giving on behalf of Allah. Because when you give the faqir, Allah is receiving. Allah gives, take from you and give the faqir. Allah loves you when He gives you, if when you give. Think about it. Allah is giving you, and then He's taking it from you to give to the faqir. You're not giving the faqir. Yadullahi fawqa aydihim, Allah says. The hand of Allah, when the faqir is putting his hand, although you are worried, you touch his dirty hand, he might give you some germs, you're going to die. Astaghfirullah al-Azim. But Allah's hand is there. You know, there are some problems that cannot be removed from your life unless you touch them and you hold them. That's why the Prophet used to love them. Allahumma ahini miskina. Oh Allah, allow me to be alive as a miskin. One only, just have his day. وَأَمِتْنِي فِي ذُمْرَةِ الْمَسَاكِينَ and let me die among them. وَحْشُرْنِي فِي ذُمْرَةِ الْمَسَاكِينَ and resurrect me with them. Many of us will never make this dua. No imam will dare to make this dua in the masjid because the musallin will get us and beat us up. More risk. اللهم ارزقنا حلالا طيبا واسعا. Ameen. Everybody says. But if I said اللهم احينا مساكين استغفر الله. Have you ever heard a sheikh doing this dua?
No.
The dua of the Prophet ﷺ. Allahumma ahlini miskina. This is sunnah. But no imam will dare. I'm telling you. The musallin will beat him up or they will never come and pray with them. Allahu Akbar. One man, a convert Muslim, whom I used to love very much, very steadfast, very strong, had a job for life working with the council in Hackney. And one night I was giving this lesson and I gave this dua on a Thursday night. Saturday, he came rushing. I was teaching in the center. And the man came and told me that somebody waiting for me. When I came down the stairs and I saw him, Salaamu alaikum, my brother, how are you? He said, I'm all right. I said to him, you look worried. What's wrong? He said, I got the sack. What do you mean you got the sack? I read the dua you told us to read. I said to him, brother, did you do it? Believe in Allah? He said, of course. I want to do what the Prophet did. I said to him, then have no fear. Allah will never let you down. But I'm worried. I have this job. I had never been unemployed in my life. I said to him, strive. Alhamdulillah, he understood and strive. But imagine the worry coming to him saying, I've been sacked. No. Allah gives. Allah never takes away. Okay. So if you give one, this verse Allah says, okay, the example of those who spend from what we gave to them, fi sabilillah, like the person who put one seed on the ground of corn, and it will grow. It gives some 7 year corns. In each year corn, there will be 100 corns. How many? 700. To me, if you give a pound, Allah will give you 700 pounds. Wallahi alladhi la ilaha illahu. I praise Allah and I thank Him and I swear by His Almighty name, which there is no name beside Him that I will swear by, that I never gave, only He has given me in abundance. This is the truth. Give, Allah will give you. Don't be frightened. لا تخاف الفقر. Don't fear poverty. Don't fear it. When Allah gives you, He will give you again. Rasulullah Sallam says, when Allah says, Allah will give you 700, but at the end of the verse, Allah says, those who are sincere in giving Allah will multiply more. You give a pound, Allah said, I'll give you 700. This is the promise. But for some, Allah will give more. In my work, when I train teachers and do this, this is my job. They ask me, how much you charge? I said, look, this is my charge. And usually you charge per day anything between 700 to 1,000 something. Wallahi, sometimes people, I go to them, and when I finish, I don't tell them what I'm earning. When I come back and I open my bag, I think they made a mistake. I ring them and said, you made a mistake. What do you mean? I said, I just did one day work and you paid me 6,000 pounds. I said, that's it. That's what you earn. That's your risk. Who gives? Not them. Allah told them to give. It's a job. It's not just going and sitting and asking them. I'm doing a job. Your work. Imagine you go to your work. Why people get bonuses? Somebody working in the city, maybe his salary at the end of the year, 200,000 pounds, but he gets a bonus of 2-3 million pounds. Because of the effort they put into the work. So they deserve that kind of thing Allah provides for them. So the very thing that we need to do in order for us to make it easier when it comes to sustenance, trusting and believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the provider and sharing from what Allah is giving to us. Give in charity and make sure you pay your zakah annually. And your zakah is 2.5% of what you have saved. You have your current account and you have your saving account. I'm not worried about your current account. I'm worried about your saving account. How much did you save there and it is staying in that account for 1 year and you have not used it? If it is equivalent to the threshold, 85 grams of gold or more, give. If it is less, no. Some people calculate it and they find there is a difference of a pound. I'm not. Just give it, for goodness sake. But these prices are made by men, maybe right or wrong. So give. You are supposed to give in everything that you have saved, except for your home that you live in, your car that you drive, and women, jewelry that they wear. But women don't buy jewelry and save it, put it in a saving place somewhere, that is saving as well. They must give 2.5% of that jewelry. But if they are wearing it, they don't have to give from it. Second thing, we must have trust Allah will never reduce our charity. But then we come to what you need to do as believers in the Prophet ﷺ, who taught us what we can do to increase the risk. This is when we are worried. Allah knows we are weak. خلق الإنسان ضعيفة. The human is weak. If suddenly you go to your workplace tomorrow morning and they say, well, your salary is going to be reduced, your number of days are going to be cut, you're going to be sacked, you're going to be made redundant. Too much fear in your heart. This is reality. So what can we do? There are things that we do. These are books written by my teachers, very good men. Sayyid Muhammad Ali al-Maliki, rahmatullah alayh, had written a very beautiful book called Abu al-Faraj, The Doors of Opening for Muslims or Believers who want to be close to Allah. In his book, he taught us, rahmatullahi alayh, that one of the best dhikr that you can read every day, the Prophet taught us, these are all from the Prophet ﷺ, to make it easier to achieve our sustenance and to have no fear, is to read, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-ali al-azim. And I'm going to read the hadith for you so that people will realize this is the Prophet teaching us. This is in Tabarani. Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, the Messenger, peace be upon him, says, من ألبسه الله نعمة فليكثر من الحمد. Whosoever Allah bestow upon them a bounty should say a lot by their tongue, Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. Increase saying this word. ومن كثر ذنوبه فليستغفر الله. Whosoever realized that he has accomplished a lot of wrong in their life, fell in the trap of shaitan and did a lot of sins, they should seek forgiveness from Allah. Astaghfirullah. Astaghfirullah. وَمَنْ أَبْطَأَ عَلَيْهِ رِزْقَهُ. And whosoever his rizq or her rizq is not coming easy to them, فَلْيُكْثِرْ مِنْ لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ الْعَلِيَ الْعَظِيمِ. He should increase the repetition of saying this statement, لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ الْعَلِيَ الْعَظِيمِ. In another hadith reported by Ibn Abi Dunya, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من قال لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم 100 مرة في كل يوم لم يصبه فقر أبدا. Whosoever recite every day 100 times لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم, you will never be poor. There is a difference between being poor and being needy, miskin. A poor meaning you have nothing. You put your hand and ask. This is being poor. And therefore we look at the Prophet, what he did about faqr. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-faqr. Oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from being needy to others. But miskin, I have my day. I have what I need for the day. Tomorrow is in your hand, ya Allah. That's miskin. So whosoever recite la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyi al-azim every day 100 times, you will never be in poverty. We try this and we do it every day. We never let it go. This is what we were taught as children. Our parents did it for us, and our children are doing, alhamdulillah. And inshallah, we hope to be kept in the future generation to come. The second thing that we need to read is Surah Al-Waqi'ah. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Imam Al-Bayhaqi, fi Shu'ab Al-Iman, a book called Shu'ab Al-Iman, Ibn Mas'ud reported that سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول, I heard the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم say, من قرأ سورة الواقعة كل ليلة لم تصبه فاقة. Whosoever recited this surah الواقعة every night before they go to bed, they will never be in need. In my country, in Saudi Arabia and in Yemen, these three countries, we are taught to always read سورة الواقعة. The way I was brought up, when we were young and learning the Quran, every day in the morning we read Yasin, and every evening we read Yasin, because it makes you happy all day and every night. The Prophet said in the hadith, every night before we go to bed, we read Surah Al-Mulk, because it's going to come and stand and protect us in the day of judgment and in the grave, so you'll not be questioned, take you to heaven. And every day after Asr, we read Surah Al-Waqi'ah, so that Allah will never make us poor. Allah will make us always give rather than receive. This is what we were taught when we were young. So read Surah Al-Waqi'ah. Oh, Anas ibn Malik says, the Prophet says, Surah Al-Waqi'ah, Surah Al-Ghina. Al-Waqi'ah is a surah of contentment. It will give you contentment. فَقْرَأُوهَا وَعَلِّمُوهَا أَوْلَادَكُمْ. Read it and recite it every day and teach it to your children. In Saudi Arabia, parents make sure the children memorize the surah. You know why? Because they lived a tough life earlier, and Allah made their life easier. They are fearing to go back to that, which was then. So never to return back to that way. So please, it is a very short surah, and you can memorize it and read it every day. كيف تأتيك الدنيا راقمة? How can dunya come easy? Many of us, subhanAllah, they work hard, but they earn little. They strive and achieve, but they don't make ends meet. And they knock doors and they close before them. And they say, life is tough. How can we make dunya easy for us? The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam teaches. Ibn Umar, the companion, radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, says, a man came to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and says, Ya Rasulullah, inna ad-dunya adbarat anni wa tawallat. O Messenger of Allah, dunya has turned away from me and left me. The Prophet turned to him and said to him, فَأَيْنَ أَنْتَ مِنْ صَلَاةَ الْمَلَائِكَ وَتَسْبِيحَ الْخَلَاقِ. Where are you from the salah of the angels and the glorification of the creation of Allah? وَبِهِ يُرْزَقُونَ, and through which they receive sustenance. That means there is a salah the malaika say, and there is a dua or a dhikr. All the creatures, like the fish in the sea, and all the birds, and all the animals, and the insects, they do, through which they receive the sustenance. When you hear the frogs making all this noise, it's not noise. They're remembering Allah to achieve their sustenance. When the birds are flying, mashallah, in beautiful formation in the heavens. They don't have any training to do this. You see, billions sometimes flying, they don't hit one another. How do they do it? This is a form of their zikr. Remember, so Allah can provide for them. He said to him, قُلْ عِنْدَ طُلُوعَ الْفَجْرِ. Say at the break of dawn, سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله العظيم أستغفر الله 100 times تأتيك الدنيا ساقرة سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله العظيم أستغفر الله Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, Subhanallah al-azim, astaghfirullah. This is one part of our zikr we do every day. But we were taught to do it after you pray your sunnah al-fajr, two raka'ahs, then we do this. Then we get up to pray fajr. When you go to the masjid, for example, and pray, they wait for you until everybody, maybe 15 minutes, 20 minutes, then the imam will lead the prayer. Why does he wait for 20 minutes? One reason is for people to come together and assemble. But another reason to give people a chance to do this askar. Because salah is for remembering Allah. And these are part of the remembrance of Allah. So you read, Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Subhanallah al-azim, astaghfirullah. Glory be to Allah and thanks. Glory be to Allah, the most great. I seek forgiveness from Him. Glory be to Allah and thanks. Glory be to Allah, the most great. I seek forgiveness from Allah. If you read this 100 times every day, dunya will come running to you. Look, what the man went and did this. Listen what happened to him. فَوَلَّ الرَّجُلُ فَمَكَثَ. The man left and spent some time. ثُمَّ عَاد. Few days later, he came back. Ya Rasulallah, O Messenger of Allah, لَقَدْ أَغْبَرَتَ الدُّنْيَا عَلَيَّ. فَمَا أَدْرِ أَيْنَ أَضَعُهَا. Dunya has come to me in abundance. I don't know where to put it. That means too much I am receiving now. I don't know what to do with it. This hadith is reported, okay, by Imam Malik, rahmatullahi alayh. So please remember, this is something that can make your life easier. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this. Lamma ahbata Allahu Adam ila al-ard, when Allah brought down Adam to the earth, qama wa ja'a al-ka'ba. Adam got up and went to the Kaaba. فصلى ركعتين. He prayed two rak'ahs. فألهمه الله هذا الدعاء. Allah has inspired him this دعاء. اللهم أنت تعلم سري وعلانيتي فاقبل معذرتي. Oh Allah, you know what I conceal within my heart and that which I make apparent. Accept my apology. وتعلم حاجتي فأعطيني سؤلي. And you know my need. Give me what I ask for. وتعلم وفي نفسي فاغفر لي ذنبي. And you know what is within me. Forgive my sins. اللهم إني أسألك إيمانا يباشر قلبي. Oh Allah, I ask you a faith that will be filling my heart. ويقينا صادقا. And conviction in trusting in you. حتى أعلم أنه لا يصيبني إلا ما اقتدت لي. Until I know nothing will harm me, only that which you have ordained for me. وأرضني بما قسمت لي. And make me content with that which you provide for me. Then Allah inspired him. Ya Adam, O Adam, قد قبلت لك توبتك. I accepted your repentance. وغفرت لك ذنبك. And forgiven your sin. ولن يدعوني أحد بهذا الدعاء. And no human will ever ask me by this دعاء إلا غفرت له. Only that I will forgive them. وكفيته. And I will give them whatever they require and they need. وَذَجَرْتَ عَنْهُ الشَّيْطَانِ. And remove the way from their path, Iblis, the devil. وَاتَّجَرْتَ لَهُ مِنْ وَرَاءِ كُلِّ تَاجِرٍ وَأَقْبَلَتْ إِلَيْهِ الدُّنْيَا رَاقِمَةً وَإِنْ لَمْ يُرِدْهَا. And everybody who will do good, he will receive from their good, and dunya will come to them even if they don't need it. Allah will make life easy. This dua, inshallah, I'm going to compile it, I'll give it to Isa. We translate it in English and then he will put it in the website and you can take it, inshallah. Everybody can get it. Arabic and English, inshallah. I will do it in Arabic and in English. Very beautiful dua. This is the part of our adhkar we read every day. Another dhikr that we do to make rizq easier, it is reported from the Prophet ﷺ, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, the Messenger, peace be upon him, says, man qala kulla yawm mi'ata marra, whosoever repeat this dhikr every day 100 times, لا إله إلا الله الملك الحق المبين. لا إله إلا الله. Everybody knows this. الملك, the king. الحق, the truth. المبين, the one who clarifies right from wrong to us. كان له أمانا من الفقر. It will be, inshallah, security for him or her from poverty. وأنسا من وحشة القبر. This is what I'm looking for. And someone who will come to sit by you when you are alone in your grave. I was taught a salah from my sheikh. I pray every night before I go to bed, called Salat al-Uns. You can pray it after Maghrib or pray it after Isha. Two rak'ahs. The first rak'ah, Allahu Akbar, Fatiha and Kafirun. Second rak'ah, Fatiha and Ikhlas. When we finish, we ask Allah, oh Allah, make those two rak'ahs a companion in the grave.
MashaAllah.
We call it Salat al-Uns.
First,
Ikhlas, Kafirun, Fatiha and Kafirun. Second, Fatiha and Ikhlas. Salat al-Uns. But if you read La ilaha illallah al-Malik al-Haqq al-Mubin 100 times a day, it will also come on. You need more companions. In your grave, you need companions. Otherwise, Munkar and Nukair, Allahu Akbar. A'udhu Billah. And the snake that comes and punishes you in your grave because Allah bestowed upon you rizq and you did not use it properly or abuse it or waste it or just store it and you die and leave it. Recently, they found a man in America. He has, I think, $500,000 in his bed, under his bed. How could you do that? You shouldn't just store money. Either utilize it, use it. I'm telling you, as young people, if you are saving money, don't save it, just save it. Invest it is better, so that people can work and use it. Better, because wealth should not be accumulated and just put like that. It should be used all the time. وَالَّذِينَ يَكْنِزُونَ الذَّهَبُ وَالْفِضَّ Allah says, those who will put it away and not utilize it, nobody is benefiting from it, it will be burnt in the hellfire, and your forehead and your side will be burnt with it. يُمَتُكْوَ بِهَا جِبَاهُهُمْ وَجُنُوبُهِمْ So I will say, but I realize as young people, you don't have a lot of saving, maybe you have 10,000, 20, you are trying to buy a property, but you cannot buy even the doorstep, leave alone the room. So what you need to do is, as young people, to think of ideas. People come together and make cooperative. 20 brothers, each body, 20, 30, brothers, and buy properties, rent them, make money. That way. I wish I was young like you, I could do these things. You see? Simple, easy. Nobody can stop you from doing this thing, but it needs young people who are trustworthy and people who can trust in them. Because a lot of people say, where am I investing? People used to come to me, Sheikh, I have 6,000 pounds. What am I? I said, I'm not a businessman. What am I going to tell you? I told people who are in business, please help them. But nobody listens. You need people to help you, inshallah, to benefit yourself. This is to do with increasing your sustenance from Sayyid Muhammad Alawi al-Maliki, from his book. Okay? Beautiful book that I love very much. Okay? Abu al-Faraj. But then we come to al-istighfar, seeking forgiveness. And in Mafatih al-Mafatih, the keys of the keys, the Sheikh says, الاستغفار هو الماء الذي نغسل به القلوب. Seeking forgiveness from Allah by just saying those two words, استغفر الله or استغفر الله العظيم. It is the water through which we cleanse our heart. لنزيل أوسخ وأغذار الذنوب. To remove the dirt, okay, of the sins that we commit. وهو النور الذي يمحو ظلمات العصيان. And it is the light that wipe away the darkness of disobedience to Allah. فَيَرْجِعُ الْعَبْدُ إِلَى نُورَ الرَّحْمَنِ Then the servant will return to the light of the one who sustained him. Because الرحمن literally meaning the one who brings you the benefit you need, which is sustenance. لِيَجْعَلْ لَهُ نُورًا نَمْشِي بِهِ To give him a light through which he can walk in this life. وَلِذَا كَانَ التَّوْبَ مِفْتَحْ لِكُلِّ فَلَحْ For this reason, tawbah, repentance, is the key for every success. Allah says, وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ And do repent fully, O you who believe. Perhaps you succeed. فالاستغفار يستنزل به الرزق والغيث. فالاستغفار يستنزل به الرزق والغيث. When we seek forgiveness, we are asking Allah to provide for us, and we are asking Allah to bring rain for us. When there is drought, we pray and ask Allah through istighfar. Allah said in the Quran, in Surah Hud, verse number 52, ويا قوم استغفروا ربكم O my people, seek forgiveness from your Lord. ثم توبوا إليه Then repent unto him. يرسل السماء عليكم مدرارا He will bring a lot of rain from the heaven for you. ويزدكم قوة إلى قوتكم And he will give you more strength to what you already have. ولا تتولوا مجرمين And do not turn away from him سبحانه وتعالى. A man came to Al-Hasan al-Basri. Al-Hasan al-Basri, He's a beautiful man, a very, very wonderful man. the greatest scholar of the Tabi'een. He died in the year 110 Hijri. Imagine, from the day the Prophet made Hijra to Medina, 110 years later, he passed away, rahmatullah alayhi. He's not just a scholar. For us, he is maybe one of the earliest scholars of what we call Zuhd. Relinquishing the love for the dunya, the lower world, and investing in the love for Allah for the hereafter. Inshallah, we're going to do a series of 12 great noblest Zahideen, men of Zuhd. Starting with Uwais al-Qarani, the Prophet asked us to read about him. And then Ali ibn al-Abidin ibn al-Husayn. And then we come to al-Hasan al-Basri and we carry on until we come to a great scholar who lives in Egypt, in the Red Sea, buried there, called Abu al-Hasan al-Shadhali. Then my idea is to do this series for us to learn how to live with dignity and honor through the example of men who lived, divorced the dunya, but yet lived with dignity and honor and worked for the hereafter. The way we're going to do it, for you to receive two rewards. The reward of learning and putting in practice, the knowledge we teach, and the reward of sponsoring an orphan. Do you realize if you sponsor an orphan for £15, he will be sheltered, clothed, and educated for 1 year. £15 a month, 1 year is 180. We're going to do 12. We will do this in 12, inshallah, weeks within 3 months or 4 months. We start in March and we finish, inshallah, sometime in May. Yeah, just before Ramadan we finish. Please register for this course because I really feel we need to help the orphan. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to love the orphans, for he is the greatest among those whom Allah has made to have that honor of being an orphan. And he made it clear, those who serve the orphan, look after the orphan, they will be closest to me in the day of judgment. So I want you, before you enter Ramadan, this will be your means of wiping away your sins. You pay that money. Either you can pay it all in advance to the charity that will look after those kids, and wallah, the charity you will sponsor through which the money will go, no charity like it. I am going to be responsible. This charity, the beautiful charity, their work, the man who established it, may Allah give him success in dunya wal akhirah. Because he said to me, Sheikh, when I wanted to sponsor the orphan or the widow or the old person, I want them to be having the same thing I'm having. I said to myself, this is a man who understands Allah, his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the deen. For Rasulullah says, لا يؤمن أحدكم. One of you will not claim to be a faithful human being until you love for your brother what you love for yourself. So the orphan homes he is building, he's not building orphanages, he's building orphan homes. So he will build a house for 10 orphan children and he will bring a woman who is a widow to live with them. And he will build a classroom for them not to go to a school, to bring teachers to teach them in that house. Privileged children. This is what you will gain, inshallah. Paying £15 a month for us is nothing. You can either... No, when we start, he will do it for you. Yeah, you sponsor. Our intention is going to be, Shnu, we're going to sponsor. I'm going to do it myself. You can sponsor 2 or 3, as you like. But believe me, either you pay the 180, so you're not really paying for us to, for the place or anything, alhamdulillah, we're going to give this money straight away to the poor child. So I'm going to enter and I say, oh Allah, we are doing this, studying the life of those beautiful men for your sake, to learn you love them because who they are. Oh Allah, as you love them through the best that they have done, love us. And we are doing what they loved. Sponsoring the orphan, looking after the orphan. So we do it and we enter Ramadan with that intention, inshallah. And Isa will put this for you there. So Al-Hasan al-Basri, a man came to him and said to him, oh Hassan, I am complaining to you about the drought we have in our area. He said to him, go back and repeat a lot of astaghfirullah. A man came to him in the same majlis and said, ya Hassan, I'm really finding it difficult earning my living. Life is becoming very hard. I'm becoming very poor. He said, say astaghfirullah. Another man in the same majlis came and said to him, oh Hassan, I am finding it difficult to achieve anything in my life. He said, say astaghfirullah. He said to them then, all of them sitting in front of him, ma qultu min indi shay'an. I never said anything from myself. When I tell you to say astaghfirullah for the drought, for poverty, for difficulty in your life, addressing the three people, but everybody who's sitting in the majlis, I am saying what Allah has taught us already. Allah said in the Quran, استغفروا ربكم إنه كان غفارا. Turn to Allah and seek His forgiveness, for indeed He is most forgiving. Once you ask Him to forgive you, He will bring you rain from the heaven. So the man with drought will get his rain. وَيُمْدِدْكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ. And for those who need money or wealth or sustenance, Allah will give them money. And for those who are seeking children, Allah will give them children. وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ. And more than that, He will write good deeds that will take you to heaven in the day of judgment. وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا. And He will give you gardens in paradise. Now, do you know that the Prophet ﷺ gave you a prescription to read every day from istighfar? In fact, he gave you few. But there is one prescription so simple, so easy. But we don't know it. And in fact, we live at a time and at an age when you find somebody like me carrying a book, in it written, awrad, they say, astaghfirullah al-azim. This is a Sufi book, we shouldn't read it. Not realizing that Sufi book only containing what the Prophet used to do every day. A wird is that which you should repeat regularly. Salah is wird. You can't join it together. You go to work in the morning and you say, look, I haven't got time to pray Fajr, but when I come back, inshallah, after I have my supper and after I play with my children and make everybody go to bed, then I will pray my Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, and Isha, inshallah. Can you do that? Of course you can. I say to the person who wants to do that, okay, don't have your breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and snacks. Have them all together at the end of the day. Put your cereals, your soup, your McDonald's, whatever you buy for your lunch, and then put your couscous, whatever, ma'aluba, and eat it at the end of the day. You can't do that. So you can't join. The Prophet gave us a prescription of something to do with seeking forgiveness. He called it Sayyidul Istighfar. Sayyidul Istighfar, the master of seeking forgiveness. He said, if you really want to be close to Allah, read it 3 times in the morning, 3 times in the evening. Let me read it as it is written by my Shaykh Rahmatullah Alayh. He says, Shaddad ibn Aws. This is one of the greatest companions. I remember my Shaykh when he used to say, Qala Shaddad. He used to sweat. I didn't used to understand. But then later when I read the story of this Shaddad, he's really Shaddad. He was a strong man who was not strong physically and want to fight people. No, he was strong in holding what the Prophet used to say. What the Prophet did, he want to do. What the Prophet said, he want to say. He want to teach people. Qala Shaddad. Shaddad says, Ibn Aws radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and in Nabi sallam, the Prophet reported, Sayyidul Istighfar, the master of seeking forgiveness. Allahumma anta Rabbi. O Allah, you are my Lord. La ilaha illa anta. There is none worthy to be worshipped but you. Khalaqtani wa ana abduk. You created me, and I am your servant. Wa ana ala ahdik. I am here to fulfill my promise to you. وَوَعْدَكْ. And your promise you gave to me. مَسْتَطَعْتْ. As much as I can. Look at the Prophet ﷺ. Because we are not going to fulfill 100%. مَسْتَطَعْتْ. أَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا صَنَعْتْ. I seek refuge in you from the evil that I have accomplished. أَبُوءُ لَكَ بِنِعْمَتِكَ عَلَيْ. And I show gratitude and thanks to you for the ni'mah or the bounty that you bestowed upon me. وَأَبُوءُ بِذَنْبِي. And I declare before you my sin. فَغْفِرْ لِي. Show me forgiveness. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَغْفِرُ الزُّنُوبَ إِلَّا أَنْ. For it is indeed, none can forgive my sin but you. When you read it, it makes you feel, Allahu Akbar. You are declaring your face to Allah. You repeat this in the morning 3 times, and in the evening 3 times. Don't say to me, well, I will read it 6 times before I go to bed. When the doctor says, 2 after breakfast, you are doctors, that's the doctor Umar sitting there. 2 after breakfast, 2 after lunch, can they take it all at once, 6 tablet at once? Can they? Of course not. You can't take 6 tablets. Well, I don't have time after lunch or I don't have breakfast. I will take them all together when I have my supper. No.
No.
Do what the Prophet told us to do. 3 times in the morning. It's not going to kill you. Just look at how short it is. Wallahi, it doesn't take me more than 30 seconds. One of them. Okay? Yani, my awrad book is quite big at home. When I got it at the beginning from the Sheikh, I said, oh my God. This is going to take me a long time to read. But then when I realized, subhanAllah, this is divided through 24 hours, it became so easy. I wanted more to read.
Another 3 at night time when you're sleeping or before you sleep?
Before you sleep. Before
and,
you.
And 3?
3 after Fajr in the morning, before you leave to go and find the rizq. Okay? This is so important, istighfar. And my sheikh, again, in Abu Abul Faraj, the doors of opening, I was reading this book one day, I was sitting in the haram, and a man was looking at me. And he was just concentrating the doors of opening, the doors of ease. And every time I tell him I'm reading, when he finished, where did you get it from? I said, we don't sell them. They're given by the sheikh. I want one of these. Can you give me this? I said to him, I would love to give it to you, but my sheikh told me 2 things you never give away. If you have only one of them. This and this. Although we are supposed to be sharers, the sheikh says, have you ever seen a soldier giving his weapon to another soldier?
No.
And go and get another one? No way. I'm a soldier of Allah. This is my weapon to find my nafs and shaitan, and this is my weapon too. So I need to keep that. If I have extra, I give it. Everything else I give, I can take my clothes and give to somebody. But my sibha and my book, if it is one, no. My sheikh once said to me, do you lend your books? I said, yeah, I do. He said, how many of them come back? I said, wallahi, many don't come back. I said, never lend your books. Because your books are very important. I love my books. If I buy anything, I buy just buy books. Because books are knowledge. So my sheikh says, in regarding istighfar, okay, in Abwabul Faraj, salam. This is to do with taking away our debt, because one of the biggest problems that we have is to pay our debt. I know a lot of us sometimes suffer, even the students who have borrowed to study. And I really don't understand those who are responsible for you today. They are asking you to borrow to study when all of us study free. In fact, some of my brothers older than me, when they went to university in Sudan, they didn't just study free. They give them a room for themselves in the university like a 5-star hotel. Wallahi, in Khartoum University. They provide for them breakfast, lunch, and dinner and snacks for free. Not like what they have at home, like a 5-star hotel. In the weekend, they don't have to go to the dining room. They can call the food to their room, and they have a menu to choose from. What do you want for breakfast? You choose. What do you want for your lunch? Like a 5-star hotel. And they give them a weekly wage, spending money. And then they give them free tickets for all the holidays to go and visit their family and come back. And when they finish their degree and they succeed, they can come to England and they do their master's degree and PhD for free. It's why we have got 3,000 or 4,000 Sudanese doctors working in Britain. They never went back. Yeah, very sad. But the country spend money on them. Why now you are suffering? I don't know. This is your luck anyway. You see, you have to borrow it. But if you have debt, don't worry about the debt because there are ways through which. Okay? Husham ibn Abdullah ibn Zubayr, the companion radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, and Umar ibn Khattab, the Khalifa, says that he was inflicted by calamity. Who was inflicted? That Umar ibn Khattab was inflicted. Fashaka إليه. He came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and complained to him. وسأله أن يأمر له بسوق. And he asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to help him by giving him some dates so that he can take, maybe sell or use to benefit his family. فقال له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to him, إن شئت أمرت لك. إن شئت, if you wish, I will ask them to give you money from بيت المال. This is like somebody unemployed want extras to go and seek from here and there. I don't encourage that. I always tell people, don't depend upon somebody else. Work for your rizq. Allah makes it easy for you. Okay? So the Prophet gave him this example. Do you want me to take from the government money and give you? Or shall I give you something else? What did he give him? وَإِنْ شِئْتَ عَلَّمْتُكَ كَلِمَاتٍ. And if you wish, I will teach you a word or some words. هُنَّ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْهُ. Better for me, because when I give you this now, you will finish it and come back again. But if I teach you this word, you will never come back to me. He said, teach me the word. What are they? He said, قُلْ أَلَّهُمَّ احْفَظْنِي بِالْإِسْلَامِ قَاعِدًا. Oh Allah, keep me by my faith while I am sitting. وَحْفَظْنِي بِالْإِسْلَامِ رَاقِدًا. Keep me with my faith while I am reclining. وَلَا تُطْمِعْ فِيَّ عَدُوًا وَلَا حَسِدًا. And don't make any enemy or envious person to want that what I have. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِمَّا أَنْتَ آخِذٌ بِنَاصِيَتِهِ. And I seek refuge in you in everything else that I worry about you are responsible for. وَأَسْأَلُكَ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ الَّذِي هُوَ بِيَدِكَ كُلُّهُ. And I ask you from all the goodness that is in your hand to give me. This is a dua given to Umar ibn Khattab by Rasulullah. He came asking for something. He said, do you want me to give you? Or shall I give you something better? What did he give him better? Dua. So we will write this dua, inshallah, and Isa will put for you, and you will benefit from. What time is it?
3:35.
Very good, alhamdulillah. Al-Hakim wal-Bayhaqi, two wonderful, mashallah, muhaddithin, they said, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said, qala li abi, you know who her father is, Abu Bakr Siddiq, said to Aisha, ala u'allimaka du'a allamnihu Rasulullah sallam. Shouldn't I, Aisha, teach you a dua the messenger taught me? وقال. And the Prophet ﷺ said to Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq, كان عيسى يعلمه الحواريين. عيسى used to teach this dua to his companion. ولو كان عليك مثل أحد لقضاه الله عنك. And even if you have a debt in weight as much as the mount of Uhud. That's a huge mountain. Imagine, who will have such debt? Only America, 4 trillion. 4 trillion? I don't know. This is terrible. Okay. You, a country in Africa, a whole country, it is budget maybe 30 billion. And here America have got 4 trillion in debt. I think it's more than that. But this is, they are ashamed to say there is more. 4 trillion. And inshallah, their new president wants to make it more. Yeah? If you have debt as much as the weight of Uhud, Allah will remove it. Aisha said, Bala, teach me this dua. Qala quli. Who's saying? Abu Bakr Siddiq. The Prophet taught him this dua and said to Aisha, you should learn it. Allahumma farij alham. O you who remove depression. Kashif al-gham. O you who remove calamities. Mujib da'wat al-muttarin. O you who answer the desperate in their need. Rahman al-Dunya wal-Akhira, the sustainer of the dunya, the lower world, and the hereafter. Wa rahimahuma, and the most merciful in both of them. Anta tarhamuni, you alone will show me mercy. Farhamni, rahmatan tughnini biha ar-rahmat man siwa. Show me mercy through which I require or need no mercy from any other creature. Qala Abu Bakr, the companion Abu Bakr said to Aisha, وَكَانَتْ عَلَيَّ ذَنَابَ مِنْ دَيْنِ. And I was in debt. وَكُنْتُ لِلدَّيْنِ كَارِهًا. And I used to dislike to be in debt. فَلَمْ أَلْبَثْ إِلَّا يَثِيرًا. I did not spend a long time, but little time. حَتَّى جَاءَنِ اللَّهُ بِعَائِدًا. Until Allah brought me benefit. فَقَضَ اللَّهُ عَنِّي مَا كَانَ عَلَيَّ مِنَ الدَّيْنِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed my debt from me. قَالَتْ عَائِشَة. Aisha then said, وَكَانَ عَلَيَّ لِأَسْمَاءَ دَيْنِ. Aisha now is telling us, after she used this dua, I borrowed from my sister Asma something, and I am in debt to her. وَكُنْتُ أَسْتَحِي مِنْهَا. I was shy from her. وَكُنْتُ أَدْعُو بِذَلِكَ. I used to make dua that Allah will give me something to cover my debt. فَمَا لَبِسْتُ يَثِيرًا. I did not spend a long time, حتى جاءنا الله برزق, until Allah brought me some رزق من ميراث, from my inheritance, a charity that I received. فقضيتها وأوليت عبد الرحمن بن بكر ثلاثة أوراق. I did not just pay my debt to my sister Asma, my brother عبد الرحمن. This is my grandfather, by the way, to my mother's side. Subhanallah. She said, because he was not really very rich, I went and I gave him ثلاثة أوراق. That means, like 3,000 dirhams, I gave it to him. That means Allah brought her a lot. By what? By reading this dua. And Allah removed her debt and gave her extra to give. وَفَضْلٌ لَنَا فَضْلٌ حَسَنٌ. And a lot remained with us that is quite beneficial. Al-Bayhaqi and Abu Dawood also reported, Abi Sa'id al-Khudari radiallahu ta'ala anhu, said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ra'a Abu Umama. Abu Umama is a companion whom the Prophet used to love and always chat and talk to. فَقَالَ لَهُ مَالَكْ. He was a little bit worried. What's wrong with you? فَقَالَ هُمُومُ الَّذِي مَتْنِي وَدِيُونَ. I have worries and debt, O Messenger of Allah. You know, when you are in debt, yani, people are very naive sometimes. When you give somebody money and they borrow from you and they see you but they do not acknowledge you or try to hide away from you, don't say, oh, I give them and look what they are doing. Because they are ashamed, they don't have to give you. Don't make their life miserable. But say, why aren't you saying salam to me? Why are you hiding yourself? Do you want them to say, because I'm in debt and I can't find the money? Do you want them to? Come on. When you see the person running away from you, you should hide from them. I find it very hard, ever in my life, giving somebody something, and then I see them and I show my face. Because I worry, then they think only of one thing. That, oh my God, he's here now. Am I going to pay my... I am worried, not them. I am worried. I don't want them to feel like that. Yeah, that's the way it should be. Shouldn't?
I imagine.
Yeah, through. Be very careful because it's not really a very nice thing. So this Abu Umama was worried. The Prophet said, "Malak, what's wrong with you?" He said, "Where is O Messenger of Allah?" And debt. قال أفلا أعلمك كلاما إذا قلته أذهب الله عنك همك وقضى عنك ديكنا. Shouldn't I teach you some words? If you repeat them, Allah will remove your depression and worries, and Allah will pay on your behalf your debt. قل إذا أصبحت وأمسيت. Say when you wake up in the morning and in the evening. Again I come. Prescription. Not once, twice, he said. In the morning and in the evening. So that you spend your day happy, and you spend your night, inshallah, happy. Say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-hammi wal-hazan. Say, Allah, I seek refuge in you from depression and sadness. وَالْعَجْزِ وَالْكَسَلِ An inability, a laziness. وَالْجُبْنُ وَالْبُخْلِ And cowardness. And being stingy. وَغَلَبَتَ الدَّيْنُ وَغَهْرَ الرِّجَالِ And not being able to pay my debt and the oppression of man. Already this dua I have written and it is in the website because I really believe the dua of seeking refuge in Allah is so important. And it is all from the Prophet ﷺ. And I read it every day. Until one day my own daughter asked me, yani, as somebody who is young, professional, living in this society, there's too many things to worry us. So I sat her down. I said to her, tell me about your worries. What worries you? What is that? I want to know. Then I realized all the things that she says to me, it is in the list the Prophet used to make dua for, seeking refuge in Allah. So we have it already ready. But there is only one condition for this. When you take it, try to read it before sunrise, before sunset. I promise you by Allah, all the things you read in it, Allah will keep you away from. There is nothing that you will have as problems in your life, only the Prophet mentioned in that dua. You will not find them in one place. Our Shaykh rahmatullahi collected them, and then I just put them together and added some of the other things that are away from them. They're beautiful. Isa, we have them. Later on, you can tell them where they can get it, inshallah. Call dua al-isti'adha, the dua of seeking refuge in Allah from things that we have. Mu'ad ibn Jabal, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, before I say that, Umama, what happened to him? He said, I took that from the Prophet ﷺ, the dua I just read. قال فقلت, I said that dua in the morning and even in the Prophet tonight. فأسحب الله همي, Allah removed my worries and sadness and depression. وقضى عني ديني, and Allah repaid my debt. This dua, take away the debt. And then Mu'adh bin Jabal, the companion, said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam missed him one day. The Prophet missed Mu'adh bin Jabal. فلما صلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أتى معاذ. When the Prophet finished his prayer, Mu'adh came. The Prophet said, Ya Mu'adh, Mali lam arak. Where were you? Look at the Prophet. Wouldn't you feel happy if you go to the masjid that you pray every day behind the imam and suddenly you miss a salah and then say, come, Umar, where were you? I miss you at dhuhr. We don't have time for this today. The imam is running to go and do a job to earn living because the masjid doesn't pay him a good salary. I was disgusted last week, an imam, subhanallah, being advertised for in East London. Beautifully in the newspaper. Okay? A vacancy for a part-time imam. You will be paid $7.20 an hour. Is he working for McDonald's of Kentucky Fried Chicken? He's an imam. What is this rubbish? How can you expect the imam to sit there? He went and studied and learned and he had this to sit there. $7.20 an hour? What is this? Disgusting, isn't it? Disgusting. So when you find your masjids are closed, when you find your imam is not there, when you talk to them in your local masjid and they are unable, because they are running after the rest. I know many imams, they go and work in restaurants as chefs. I know many imams, they go and do sewing, sew clothing. At home, they send them from the north, east, you see? Bradford, Manchester, there are some companies still making textile. They send them the clothes, they have to sew it because it's cheaper. And they pay them per hour to do this. So when you are asking where my imam is, he's not going around sleeping or wasting his time, he's earning his rizq because the money he earned from his masjid is not. And every Friday, all of us sit down there in the masjid, pay to give the masjid to be run. I don't know what they do. This should go for those people who are working in the masjid.
Yeah, one of the biggest masjids in London now, here. Where's the imam? There's no imam.
That's the problem.
If I tell you, you know why I'm speaking about.
I know.
There's no imam.
All the masjid. Wallahi, the first job I got in a masjid, and this is Allah is my witness, they called me in, and I didn't. This is when I told you, when they called me, there's a job. So I got the job, and the man said to me, you got the job, inshallah. I said, fine. He said, we are going to pay you, inshallah, £125. It was a lot of money then. So I said, weekly, alhamdulillah, fine, to pay my rent, and I can live. I waited for the first week, nothing happened. Second week, nothing happened. Third week, nothing happened. End of the month, the man gave me an envelope, £125. I put it in. Maybe he forgot the other 3 weeks. I waited. Maybe he will come back to me. He didn't come to me. At the end of the month, I received another envelope, £125. Then I realized, it's for the month. Do you know I did what? I just said, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. I didn't say nothing. And Allah, through His generosity, brought me something that I could never even dream of. But then I made myself a promise. I will never take a full-time job in a masjid. Because you cannot do your job for the people whom you are supposed to be responsible for. If you have a family, you have to go and work. Your children to buy things for, to send them to school. It's very difficult to run a family. Very hard. Can you run a family with £125 a month? You can't. So you as professional people, when you go to the masjid in your local areas, you should question these things. Don't say, oh, there is no imam in the masjid. Ask why the imam is not there. Ask the people who are responsible, how much do you pay the imam? We worked very hard to bring chaplains to prison, chaplains to hospitals. The first chaplaincy, I gave it to a colleague of mine. It was offered to me. I said, no, I don't want it. Wallahi, until today, he prays for me. Because in his local mosque, when he used to work, maybe he earned about £10,000 a year. But they gave him straight away £37,000 a year. Another chaplaincy came in a secondary school. I said to him, no, we don't do this. Because at the end of the day, we need to earn our money properly so that we can do our job. Without earning, you can't look after yourself. So here, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, said the Prophet missed me in my prayer. He called upon me and said, Ya Mu'adh, ma li lam arak? Why didn't I see you? He said, Ya Rasulallah, li Yahudi indi uqiyya min tibr. Fakharajta ilayhi fahabasani. A Jewish friend of mine, I borrowed from him. I went to see him. He kept me. فَقَالَ لَهُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ The messenger peace be upon him said to him, يَا مَعَاذْ أَلَا أُعَلِّمَكَ دُعَاءَ Shouldn't I teach you a dua, O مَعَاذْ تَدْعُو بِهِ لَوْ كَانَ عَلَيْكَ مِنَ الدَّيْنِ مِثْلِ صَبْرْ أَدَّهُ عَنْكَ If you have as much debt as صبر, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take away from you. And صبر is a mountain in Yemen. If your debt is as heavy as the mount of sabr in Yemen, Allah will. فَادْعُوا اللَّهِ يَا مُعَاذُ وَقُلْ Call upon Allah, O Mu'adh, and say, Allahumma malika al-mulk. O Allah, the owner of the kingdom of the heaven and the earth. تُؤْتِ الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ You give kingship to whomever you wish. وَتَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ And you take it away from whomever you wish. وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُعِذُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ You honor those whom you wish, and you dishonor those whom you wish. بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرُ In your hand you possess all the goodness. إِنَّكَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ You are able to do everything. تُلُجُ اللَّيْلَ فِي النَّهَارِ وَتُلُجُ النَّهَارَ مِنَ اللَّيْلِ فِي اللَّيْلِ You bring the darkness from the day, and you bring the day into the night. وَتُخْرُجُ الْحَيَّ مِنَ الْمَيِّتِ وَتُخْرُجُ الْمَيِّتَ مِنَ الْحَيِّ You bring the living from the dead, and you bring the dead from the living. وَتَرْزُقُ مَنْ تَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ And you sustain whomever you wishes without count. رَحْمَنَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ Sustainer of the lower world and the hereafter. وَرَحِيمَهُمَا And most merciful in both of them. تُعْطِي مِنْهُمَا مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتَمْنَعُ مَنْ تَشَاءُ In both world, you give whomever you wish and you refuse whomever you wish. إِرْحَمْنِي رَحْمَةً تُغْنِينِي بِهَا عَنْ رَحْمَةً مَنْ سِوَاكَ Show me a mercy that will make me content from any other mercy from any other beside you. Now, from this, we realize the Prophet already gave us things to do. We don't need to worry. The worst thing I see today among people is that they complain too much. I see people, today is the 27th, tomorrow 28th, in the last day. Salary tomorrow will go to the accounts. But believe me, by Friday when I'm doing my Jum'ah, I meet someone who comes and say, Sheikh, please pray for me. What's wrong? I have nothing. Did you receive your salary? Yes, I did it. It just went in and went out. Don't complain. Because when you're complaining against Allah. It's not your boss who gave you less or more. When I said my story about the 125, I didn't tell anybody. I'm telling you now because this is a long time ago, almost 35, 40 years ago. Sister, but don't complain. Because when you complain, you're complaining against Allah. وَهُوَ لَا يُذْأَلْ وَهُمْ يُسْأَلُونَ Allah cannot be questioned, but we will be questioned by Him. Number two, just read the du'as. Depend upon Him. Realize it is Him who gives you. And strive in your will by being honest, truthful, steadfast, punctual, and never make any reason not to do your job properly. And another riwayah, the same hadith, Ma'az says, كان للرجل علي بعض الحق فخشيته. A man whom I borrowed from, I kept away from him for 2 days. I don't come out. And then after 2 days I came out, I came to the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He said, Oh Ma'az, what kept you? What kept you? The same story but in a different way it is related. He said, A man I borrowed from and I could not pay for him. I worried that he meet me and I feel ashamed. And I did not want to let myself down. So I kept myself so that he would not meet me. And then he said, Ala amuraka bi kalimat, shouldn't I command you? He didn't say, Shall I teach you? Shouldn't I command you to read those words? And if you have a mountain weight of debt, Allah will take it away from you. Ma'ad then said, I said, Bala, of course. And he taught him the same thing, same dua. Okay. One of the things that I have learned, if you just read those verses, verses 25 and 26 from Surah Ali Imran, Surah number 3, it's good for your debt. I have a word I learned of Quran. It's story is quite brief. Maybe in the future we'll just do it and I can give it to you. It is cut verses. I learned from different scholars from around the... Wallahi, some of them I did not even went to ask them. They came themselves and gave it to me. One of them was so strange. I had a cousin I never go out with in Sudan. I was in a rush to do something. He saw me, he said, Where are you going? I said, I'm going to Khartoum. I want to do something. He said, You are in a holiday. I will take you. I said, My God. He's going to waste my time for me. He's a little bit, rahmatullah alayhi, pastor, may Allah bless his soul. But he's more fascinated by the dunya rather than the deen. I like to accompany somebody who will ask me questions about the deen, talk about the mashayikh, the awliya, the salihin. But this man talks about dunya. So I had to go with him. So we went together. He was driving me. Another nephew who was driving me, he said to me, no, I'm going to drive him. So straight away he took me after a bank. And the moment we went to the bank, he said to me, look, we need to see someone here. I said to him, look, I'm coming to do something. Shall we do it first? He said, okay. But I wanted to introduce someone. I said, no, we come back later on. So we went to the place we want to go. He took me to somebody whom he knows to ask him what I want. While we were there, this my stranger just walked in, says salam to the officer in the office, and then turned to me and held me, said, your name is so-and-so? I said, yes. You just arrived from abroad? I said, yes. I have an amana for you. I have something being given to me to give to you. My cousin said to him, excuse me, I don't like these things. Just go away. You need something, you want money from him. Just go away. He doesn't know me. So the man just walked away. We finished, we went to the bank. Different area, different place. We're standing for the person to come and take us to the office of this person who wants to introduce me to. And the same man walking. He saw me, he said to me, where is your cousin? I didn't tell him he's my cousin. I said to him, he went to the stairs to see his friend and he was going to call me. I'm waiting down the stairs. He says, before he comes, I know you don't want to be with him, but Allah has made this possible for you for a reason I'm not going to talk about. But I have an amana to give to you. There is something being given to me. And he taught me a few verses from different surahs of the Quran. He said, you must read this every day. And so on. There is many stories to link to it. Now, in my journey, when I put all those things together, I read them in the morning, I read them in the evening. Some people used to question me, why do you read those things? I said, what is to you? Why is it bothering? Some of my friends, my brothers, I used to read in front of them. Until one day, I was sitting there feeling sad. Maybe I'm wrong reading all those things together. This great scholar says, today I'm going to relate to you a story of a great scholar and a great companion of the Prophet ﷺ, the only man the Prophet taught who entered paradise before everybody. Everybody will enter paradise in the Day of Judgment, but this man entered paradise in the dunya before the hereafter. Every day he goes to heaven. That is Bilal. And Bilal did not used to pronounce properly because he was from a tribe called Al-Habash, from Abyssinia. His sin used to be sheen when he says, or his sheen used to be seen when he said, Ashadu, say Ashadu. But yet, he used to recite 13 verses from the Quran. The Prophet used to teach as specific verses with benefits in them. So the companion, when they used to hear him reciting them, they got upset. Why are you mixing the Quran? Like a salad it becomes. One verse from Al-Baqarah, one verse from Al-Imran, two verses from here. They went and complained to the Prophet ﷺ. I was listening. Because my friend, my companion, used to come and complain to me. I want to see, maybe I am wrong. He says, the Prophet called him, Ya Bilal, is it true that what they say, you mix the Quran with the Quran? He said, yes, Ya Rasulullah. And why do you do these things? He says, Inni akhlatu at-tib bit-tib. Inni akhlatu at-tib. I mix the good with the good. He says, Tibta. Then you are very good. Carry on. I was going to jump up and down. Yeah, because when you are trying to do good, and people who may be more knowledgeable than yourself, and you were young at that time, I said to myself, maybe I'm doing wrong. I was really worried going to my bed. I was almost going to stop. I never stopped. So inshallah, one day, as a gift for you, I'm going to print them together, and I'm going to give them to you as a present for me. Really, I find them, it makes me happy. Wow. Beautiful verses of the Quran. The Prophet in each one of them says something. But nobody put them together. And inshallah I'll put them together and you can read them. Bilal used to, but they have never been collected from him to show us how to do them. Now, before the time takes us away, there are more. I'll just put the du'as for you regarding this. But I want to come to another thing which is very important. To open the door, the first for us to be able to have no worries. Because a lot of the thing that when sustenance is difficult, when you are unemployed, when you are looking for a job and you apply for too many jobs and you don't get anything, the best I found is Surah Al-Fatiha. Imam Al-Ghazali, rahmatullah alayh, taught his student that if you are really not taking this surah seriously and reading it a lot in your day, then you are in trouble. Surah Al-Fatiha is a key for healing. Physical, spiritual, emotional, psychological problem within the human being. Surah Al-Fatiha is a means of pushing away your difficulties and problems. Surah Al-Fatiha is a means of helping you so that you achieve ease in achieving your sustenance for your day and for your future. And moreover, taking away all your worries and fears. Now, in Mafatih al-Mafatih, the Sheikh says, Rahmatullahi alayh, that Imam Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu says in a poet, this is Imam al-Ghazali reporting, Imam al-Ghazali is reporting that Ali ibn Abi Talib recited this poem. I'm going to read for you and translate. In regard of Surah Al-Fatiha and achieving ease when you are working to sustain yourself. إذا ما كنت ملتمسا لرزق ونيل القصد من عبد وحر. When you are striving to achieve sustenance and accomplishing what you are rushing for from somebody who is able or somebody who is unable, وتصفر بالذي ترجو سريعا وتأمن من مخالفة وغدر. And to achieve what you are hoping for quick and to be safe from someone attacking you for being unable to give or pay, ففاتحة الكتاب. Then I advise you to recite the opening of the book, Surah Al-Fatiha. فإن فيها لما أملت سرا أي سري. For indeed, in it, for what you require and need, there is a secret. But what secret can I tell you about? فَلَاذِمْ ذِكْرُهَا عُقْبَى مَسَاءً. Regularly read it early morning and early evening. وَفِي صُبْحٍ وَفِي ظُهْرٍ وَعَصْرٍ. And at the break of the light of the day, and after ظُهْر and after عَصْر. كَذَلِكَ بَعْدُ مَغْرِبٍ كُلَّ لَيْلٍ. Also after Maghrib and in the night after Isha, إلى التسعين تتبعها بعشر. 90 times and add 10 to make it 100. تنال ما شئت من عز وجاه. You will achieve whatever you wish of honor and increase in sustenance. وعظم مهابة وعلو قدر. And Allah will give you a place and position and people will look up to you. وستر لا تغيره الليالي. And a shelter, it will never be changed. بحادثة من النقصان تجري. Whatever happened to you, nothing will happen to you. وتوفيق وأفراح دواما. And success and joyous, you will be regularly. وتأمن من مخاوف كل شر. And you will be safe from the fear of any evil. ومن فقر وعسر وانقطاع. And also you will be safe from poverty, difficulty, and being unable to do for yourself. ومن بطش لذي نهي وأمر. And even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be gentle and kind towards you. Now when we learn this, I was so grateful to Allah that my Shaykh taught me to read Fatiha every day 100 times. But I never knew until they taught us this poem that Imam al-Ghazali wrote it from Ali ibn Abi Talib. We read 100 times, but we read in the morning after Fajr 18 times, after Zuhur 18 times, after Asr 18 times, after Maghrib 18 times. And then after Isha, 28 times. This is the way my Sheikh prescribed it for me. I read like that. Imam al-Ghazali says, read it after each prayer 20 times. So that you don't. I didn't ask my Sheikh why 18, 18 and 28. Because we don't ask. Otherwise I'll be like Musa asking Khidr. He must say to me, now go your way. I don't want that. What they tell me to do, I just do. But for you, if you want to do, either you do what I was told to do and you have right to do it, or you read after every salah 20 times. And for people who are not able to read after salah every time, I encourage you read Fatiha every day 100 times and see what Allah will give to you. The other thing, other than Surah Al-Fatiha, for those who want even greater increase in ease, generally in your life, spiritually, emotionally, psychologically, physically, okay, sustenance, wife, whatever. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. You notice in all the Pakistani shops, they put 786. And people who are thinking this is bid'ah, say, astaghfirullah al-azim. The Prophet never says 786. What is this, astaghfirullah al-azim? These people are writing 786 because they fear that if they write from Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim and somebody does something wrong, then they are to be blamed. So they write the numbers. Although the numbers carry the same responsibility as the letters. For the letters are numbers at the end of the day. This is called abjad hawaz, ilm al-harf, the knowledge of the letter. This is the only knowledge through which power can be achieved. The scientists can go and achieve power through the elements of science. But the scholars, whom Allah opened their heart, they can achieve the success through the letter. When I was striving to learn ilm al-harf, my sheikh said to me, at any time, in any generation, there will only be a handful of men in the world who know this knowledge. Because this knowledge is most powerful than any other knowledge. Not even the scientists. Because through which they can take a piece of rock and make it into gold. They can take water and make it into milk. Not through magic, through kun fayakun. Be and it becomes. Allah says so. We can. But not for everyone. Alhamdulillah, I met people like that. I sat with them. I learned from them. One of them taught me something, but I never use. And I'm not going to use, inshallah. He told me to make a bag, and he gave me a dhikr. He said, son, because you are a da'ya, you don't want to depend upon people. The place where you pray, make it one place. It's good in your home to have one place you make your prayer. Maryam used to pray in the same place. When Zakaria used to come to her, he find in her room food. One day he questioned her. Min ayna laki hada? Where did you get this from? Wa min indillah. She is young, she pointed, it's from Allah. Not because Allah is there, because it's high. The Almighty Allah. So he looked up. Nothing is there. There's a ceiling. But when he looked down, where she pointed, it's her prayer place. هُنَالِكَ دَعَى ذَكَرِيَ رَبُّهُ. There, Zakaria kneeled and prayed. And while he's praying in her mihrab, the malaika said, we are giving you the good tidings, you're going to have a son. He was praying himself in his own place. Every day, nothing happened. But there, Allah gave. What happened to me? He got worried. Oh, Allah. What people will say about me? I'm an old man. Allah said, don't worry. And then you met my wife, she's a grandmother. Imagine if you're going to the street, see a grandmother with her stick and she's pregnant. It's not a sight that you want to look at. Only young people carry children. But Allah says, for this, there is a wisdom. We're going to give you a child. Nobody was named after, given his name before you. And he's going to be Yahya. لَمْ نَجْعَلْ لَهُ مِنْ قَبْلُ سَمِيلٍ. Okay? So, subhanAllah, the place where you pray, he said to me, in the front right corner, put this bag and read this dhikr every day. He gave me a time. I'm not saying the dhikr. I'm not saying the timing. It's a promise. And he says, every day when you pray your duha, prayer, open the prayer mat underneath, open the bag, you find your sustenance for the day. But he said, I don't encourage you to do it. I taught you, but I never. Guess what? If I was going to be somebody who is in haste, I will do it. But I realized, no. وَلَلْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. Indeed, the hereafter is better and forever. I have a lot of my brothers who can just go like this and they can get what they want. But we don't want that. A lot of the younger generation today, when they are looking for the spiritual path and they are seekers, they don't really want to be a follower of a sheikh. They want to be the sheikh. They don't really want just to be the sheikh. They want to have the miracle of the sheikh. You can't just have it like that. You see? You can't. You need to strive, to struggle. And this, Allah can give it to you if He wishes. So, don't worry about it. So, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, if it is recited 786 times a day, and the person keeps it every day, Allah takes away everything that you require. But for those who are unable to do that, you read it the way I was taught. In the morning before you go out, read it 19 times. And in the evening before you go to bed, read it 21 times. كَفَاكَ اللَّهُمَّ شِيْءٍ. That's it. Allah will save you from whatever you worry about. 19 times in the morning before you leave your home, and 21 times before you... If you put it, you know, somebody who can't sleep at night.
Like me.
Just believe me. 21 times you sleep. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. When I was told this, before I finished, I said 7 or 8, I just snoring. Alhamdulillah. Since then, I just put my head and I sleep. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is for sleeping. If there is somebody sick, You read Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim for them in water 150 times, and they will be, inshallah. I'm going to finish by the last part, which is verses of the Quran that will help, inshallah, in this, from the Mafatih, which is 31, inshallah. And that will be the end of what we are talking about. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our Prophet, peace be upon him, says, من أتى منزله, whosoever enters his house, فَقَرَأَ سُورَةَ الْحَمْدِ. Once you enter, most of us when we enter, it's very strange. I don't know why people do this. First of all, we come and we are very upset. We carry all the worries in our head. In the house, you have a mother, maybe a father, maybe siblings, maybe grandparents, maybe a wife, maybe even children. And they're waiting for you to come. And you're coming in, you don't know which foot came in first. And the first thing, rather than doing the right thing, if they ask you, did you bring milk? An argument. We're just asking. Did you do this for us? No way you should act like that. If you did what the Prophet did. The Prophet says, when you come into your home, Shaitan is following. And with him, his soldiers. If you enter your home with your left foot, he will say to some of his soldiers, he is inviting you to join him. And if you enter with your left foot, and you close your door, and you do not read what the Prophet said, read. You say, should read Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Bismillah wulajna, Bismillah kharajna. In the name of Allah, we exited, and in the name of Allah, I'm returning back. You read this dua when you're going out, when you're coming in. And then you read Surah Al-Fatiha. Straight away, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Malik Yawm al-Din, Iyaka na'budu, Iyaka nasta'in, Ihdina as-salata al-mustaqim, salata al-lazina an'amta alayhim, ghayril maghdubi alayhim, wala ad-dallin, Ameen. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد والله الله is my witness we do this and we treat him. And I have got my grandson is 2 years old when he's going out I always try to walk him by the door so that he go. Now he is learning he can never put his right he put his left foot out first when they're bringing him I said don't carry him let him because he can walk I want him to enter with the right once he begins to speak properly then I'll teach him how to say my children alhamdulillah We have to. My father taught me. We have to teach one another. Because the Prophet ﷺ says, whosoever recite Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, wal-ikhlas, when you enter your home, nafa Allahu anhu al-faqr wa kathura khayri baytihi. Allah will remove and wipe away poverty from your life and your sustenance will be increased in your home. Whatever Allah provides, there will be barakah in it. You know, sometimes you have a lot, but there is no blessing in it. You have little, there is blessing in it. We have learned not to worry. If we cooked food that can feed 10 people and suddenly 50 can, it will feed all of us. But for some of you, you'll pull your hair. Oh my God, we're going to be shamed up. It's going to be the talk of the town that we are didn't cook enough. No, if you just recite these verses, blow on the food, everybody will eat. That's what we do, you see. One day, my sheikh, they were inviting about 150 people to come for a meeting with him. And the people who cook in the back, they were cooking, preparing. And suddenly, almost maybe 300-400 people came. So the brothers were so worried. So one of the brothers told me, so we went and told the sheikh. I said, sheikh, he's an old man. The brothers were worried. I said, why are they worried? The food will be enough. And one brother came, he's so clever. I said, sheikh, but we didn't think. I mean, we cooked maybe a food that can food 200, but double that one. And the number is 150. We could maybe can feed 200, but double is going to tough. The sheikh said, "Show me the food." And he was walking around the food they're making. I was not watching the food or them. I was watching the sheikh. Why? Because Allah says, "Don't take your eye away from those people who remember me." Because the sheikh is always remembering. I want to see what he was reading, because I know he was doing something, and he was reading something, and I picked it up. And every time he was doing like this by his hand. Don't worry. And saying, Ameen. I promise you by Allah, everybody ate and everybody enjoyed the food and there was food. And they kept, Sheikh, mashallah, there was 12 barakah. I told you. There was more food to feed more people. Don't panic. Because Allah can put blessing in what you have and Allah will give it to you. And then it is also reported that a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and complained to him about poverty and difficulty in living his life. The Prophet ﷺ said to him, when you enter your dwelling, your home, فسلم. After you recite Bismillahi walajna, Bismillahi kharajna, al-Fatiha, and then ikhlas, then say, Assalamu alaykum ahl al-dar. Peace be upon you, dwellers of the house. Because don't forget, in every house that is you by yourself or whoever lives with you, there is the dwellers. You know who the dwellers are? Jinn. Don't be frightened tonight. There are jinn living in your house. Okay? If they're not disturbing you, that means everything is safe. Don't worry. But every house, there is jinn in it. And some of them are Muslim, some of them are not Muslim. So we say, Assalamu alaikum ahl al-dar. Peace be upon you, dwellers of the house. All of them. Okay? فَسَلِّمْ إِنْ كَانَ فِيهِ أَحَدْ أَوْ لَمْ يَكُنْ فِيهِ أَحَدْ. Say salam if there is someone there or there is nobody there. The wise person will say, if there is somebody there, yes, I understand. But if there is not somebody there, why should I say salam? There are dwellers. Why I say that to you? ثُمَّ صَلِّي وَسَلِّمْ. Then say, اللهم صلِّ عَلَى مُحَمَّدْ وَعَلَى آلِ مُحَمَّدْ وَسَلِّمْ عَلَيَّ وَصَلِّي وَسَلِّمْ عَلَيَّ. Make salawat and salam for me. وَقْرَأْ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ مَرَّ وَاحِدَةً. And then read, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ one time. Allah will make it. ففعل الرجل مدة. The man started doing this for a time. فأدر الله عليه الرزق حتى أفاء على جيرانه وأقربائه. Allah brought too much sustenance for him until he began to give his relatives and his neighbors. Okay. And also there is a verse in the Quran, in Surah Al-A'raf, to increase your sustenance. ولقد مكناكم في الأرض وجعلنا لكم فيها معيشة قليلا ما تشكرون. And we have made it easy for you to sustain yourself from the earth, and we made in it different ways of earning your rizq. But however little you show ingratitude. Inshallah, these verses and others, I will put them together and I will write their translation so that inshallah you will be able to understand and appreciate that the first thing, you should not worry about your rizq. But by nature, as a human being, you'll be worried. The worry comes because of fear. But fear, if you are truly a believer, is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah said, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ. We will test you with some fear. No doubt. So when fear comes, straight away, you repeat, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. We are from Allah and to Him we return. We are a spiritual being, not physical being. You shouldn't worry. And number two, you should realize that fear could lead to sadness, that which could lead to anxiety, to depression. By reciting the dua I told you three times in the mosque, all these things will not be there. And you should be a truthful, honest believer by knowing that Allah is the one who sustains you. Not your employer, not your parents. Your parents are responsible for you because Allah made them responsible. Your employer is responsible for paying your wage, your salary, because Allah made it so. Your job is to seek the halal rizq and the good when you buy. Your job is to share from what Allah has given to you with those who are weaker than yourself. And Ramadan is going to come. And we're beginning soon, inshallah, after this month finishes. Jamad al-Akhirah, Rajab is coming, inshallah. April, okay? And your March, Rajab will begin. Then we'll have Sha'ban in May. And then, inshallah, Ramadan will start at the end of May. Now we need to prepare ourselves for Ramadan. Please take this from me seriously. In the world we live in today, the biggest fear for people is poverty. But yet we live in a world when we have abundance. When we look at the people who are really poor, they don't have nothing, they are picking from the bins. But still they are sustaining themselves. I was so shocked when I saw once a documentary about the poorest people in Bombay in India who are living in a place whereby they have nothing, but they have industry. They go to the picking of the rich bins of the rich people and they bring it to their little shanty town in the middle of Bombay. And in fact, among them, one became a millionaire through recycling. He's a multi-millionaire living in that. He was just a poor man. But now employing all those poor people to go and pick, bring him the plastic, bring him the whatever, and he's recycling it. And they are selling it. Allah can give everybody as much as they deserve if they know how to get it, inshallah. If anybody have a question, please ask any question. I'm always happy that people, yeah. So now, inshallah, I'm going to repeat again for those who came later. Inshallah, to fulfill this, we are going to do a course. We'll start soon. And this course, I am doing it for Allah's sake, for the orphan kids. I want everybody who want to join the course is to sponsor a child, an orphan kid. £15 a month. You can pay it all at once for a year, 180, instead of asking you to pay for rumiscave. No. We're going to pay it for the orphan kids. Isa will put it in the website, inshallah. And he can speak to you and tell you about it after I finish. And either pay it at once if you are able to, or pay monthly. Okay? I want to do it all at once, or pay it in the next, once we start 3 months, because I want to enter Ramadan. My intention, oh Allah, I'm going to sponsor an orphan child so that you wipe my sin and prepare me to enter into Ramadan so I benefit myself. Wallahi, I tell you, and this is just for your benefit, for goodness. I made this intention with you. I began to sit at home and prepare for it. And yesterday I was so busy, and then they called me to do something. I went to the masjid. And then I came back, and I was in pain. If you ask, my family will tell you, my knees were hurting me. I was unable to sleep. Alhamdulillah, I got up, I did my prayers. At this. But then, just before the Fajr prayer, I slept. And guess what? I saw myself, because I was worried about this thing for the orphan, saw myself entering the haram. And a person called me, come, we are going to open the Kaaba for you. And the man who hold the key said, I have the key for you. So the moment he said this, I began to cry, and a verse came to my hand. Okay? وَمَنْ دَخَلَهُ كَانَ آمِنًا I began to read it. وَمَنْ دَخَلَهُ And whosoever enter it will be secure. And I came to the door of the Kaaba. And when I came to the door of the Kaaba, another man came and said to the man who hold the key, said to him, before you do this key, I want to say something. There are two keys. There is a key and there is a key. There is a physical and there is a spiritual. Okay? You open with your key, which is the physical, the Shaybani family, they hold it. But I will give you, my son, my key. My key is not like his key. His key go back to his bag. They have a bag for it. But my key, once you open with it, it will go to its place by itself. So he went like this. After the man opened for me, and he gave me a key. I opened with it. I didn't have to give it back. It just went away. And I entered. I saw a few people sitting. I wanted to pray. So I asked myself, which direction? The boy said to me, ask one of those sitting. Then I went to him. I said to him, which direction? He said, pray any direction you want. Because you pray towards the Kaaba, but you already tied the Kaaba. So I prayed. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to achieve success through learning about the 12 greatest, noblest human beings who relinquished the love of the dunya for the... This I intended it. Look what Allah gave me. Wallahi, I'm saying it out of gratitude to Allah, to you. Because Allah could give you anything. I'm just thinking about it, thinking about Isa, and we're discussing it, worried about how am I going to put it, how we're going to do it, how can we... And Allah gave me this. If He doesn't give me anything else, I'm happy. That is enough for me. May Allah give you and give me tawfiq fi dunya wal akhirah. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wa sallim ya Allah. Ya Rahman ya Rahim ya Arhamar Rahimin. Ya Arhamar Rahimin. Ya Arhamar Rahimin. Ya Rahman ad-dunya wa ya Rahim al-akhirah. Ya mufattih al-abwab, ya musabbib al-asbab, ya dalil al-mutahayyirin, ya qiyath al-mustaqithin, ya sarikh al-mustasrikhin, ya qiblat al-mutawajjihin, ya aman al-khaifin, ya kanz al-du'afa' wal-fuqara' wal-masakin. أتيناك ربي طالبين راقبين راجين من فضلك العظيم وأنت ذو الفضل العظيم أنت الذي أنزلت في كتابك الكريم أدعوني أستجب لكم إني قريب أجيب دعوة الداعي إذا دعان فليستجيبوا لي وليؤمنوا بي لعلهم يرشدون ربي ها نحن عبيدك بني عبيدك بني إماءك نواصينا بيدك ماض فينا حكمك عدل فينا قضاؤك نسألك اللهم بكل إثم وكتميت به نفسك أنزلته في كتابك أو علمته أحدا من خلقك أو استأثرت به في علم الغيب عندك اللهم يا ربنا فإنا قد استجبنا لدعاك فدعوناك بما أنت أهل له يا كريم نسألك اللهم بأسمائك الحسنى العظام وباسمك العظيم الأعظم محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم وما آتيتهم من رحمة حيث أصبح رحمة للعالمين فقال إنما رحمة مهدا نتوسل به إليك يا الله إلا ما تنزلت علينا في هذه الساعة آمين. برحمة من عندك فأنت أرحم الرحماء آمين. أرحم الراحمين آمين. فيا رحمن يا رحيم يا أرحم الراحمين يا أرحم الراحمين يا أرحم الراحمين إما بعثته رحمة للعالمين إلا ما رحمتنا في هذه الساعة بأن تمحو عنا كل ذنب وعيب ربنا امحو عنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وآتينا سؤلنا وبلغنا مقصودنا يا كريم اللهم ربي أنت ربي لا إله إلا أنت عليك توكلنا وإليك أنبنا وإليك المصير ربي اغفر وارحم وأنت خير الراحمين ربي اغفر وارحم وأنت خير الراحمين ربي اغفر وارحم وأنت خير الراحمين اللهم أنت ربي لا إله إلا أنت خلقتني وأنا عبدك وأنا على عهدك ووعدك ما استطعت أعوذ بك من شر ما صنعت أبو لك بنعمتك علي وأبو بذنبي فاغفر لي فإنه لا يغفر الذنوب إلا أنت يا أرحم الراحمين رب اغفر لنا ولوالدينا ولمشايخنا ولمن علمنا ولمن له حق علينا وللسائل والمحروم ولكافة المسلمين أجمعين يا رب اشفنا واشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين اغفر اللهم لنا ولموتانا وموتى المسلمين وانصر اللهم الإسلام والمسلمين يا رب هيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا واجعل معونتك الحسنى لنا مددا بالأولياء بالصالحين بجمعهم من جاءنا القرآن عنهم مرشدا فرج بفضلك إلهي كربنا يا خير مد الآن ما له يدا اللهم إنا نسألك سلطانا نصيرا وحظا عظيما وأجرا وفيرا وتجارة لن تبور وفقنا توفيقا مطلقا وارزقنا حلالا طيبا واسعا بلا كد تجب دعاءنا بلا رد آتنا اللهم كلمة لا ترد خن اللهم الجنة بغير حساب إنك أنت الله العزيز الكريم الوهاب ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربي اغفر وارحم وأنت خير الراحمين غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير I ask الله سبحانه وتعالى for all the suffering people all over the world O Allah, those who are sick, may you heal them. Those who are serving them from the nurses, the porters, the doctors, and those who look after the hospital and hospices, may you look after them. O Allah, serve them as they serve them, Ya Kareem. I ask Allah for the unemployed to be given dignity of wealth. I ask Allah for the employers, may you increase their sustenance to give dignity to those who are unemployed, Ya Kareem. I ask Allah for those who are seeking to be complete by marriage, to find them the best of partners. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those who are seeking opening from Allah for difficulties that they are going through. May Allah remove all their difficulties. I ask Allah for those who find it difficult to wake up for Fajr in the morning. May Allah make it easy for them to wake up for Fajr. I ask Allah for those people who are unable to sustain their remembrance of Allah regularly to make it easy for them to remember you, Ya Allah. I ask Allah for those who have parents but their life difficult with them. May they be in the best relationship with their parents, Ya Kareem. Those who have parents like myself who passed away, may Allah forgive them and raise them into the highest loftiest place in Jannah. May they forgive us for the wrong that we have done towards them, Ya Kareem. Those who are alive, may Allah give them long life with obedience. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our partners in marriage. May Allah give them tawfiq and success. I ask Allah for my wife. May Allah give her tawfiq. May Allah give her success. May Allah give her as much as she has given me, Ya Kareem. And give her success for dunya wal akhirah. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our mashaykh, our teachers, those who taught us. May Allah give them tawfiq for dunya wal akhirah. Those who passed away, may Allah give them the highest place in Jannah. Those who are alive, may Allah give them the best position, Ya Kareem. And for anybody sitting here having something in their heart concealed, we don't know, but Allah knows. May Allah fulfill for them whatever they need and they want, Ya Kareem. ربنا اغفر لنا وارحمنا واسترنا وانصرنا أيدنا وكلنا ولا تكن علينا يا كريم. يا ربي بالمصطفى بلغ مغاصدنا واغفر لنا ما مضى يا واسع الكرم يا ربي بالمصطفى بلغ مغاصدنا واغفر لنا ما مضى يا واسع الكرم يا ربي بالمصطفى بلغ مغاصدنا واغفر لنا ما مضى يا واسع الكرم اكتبنا عندك ربنا من المقبولين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين صلي وسلم على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمين وآله وسلم إلى شرف النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم وإلى جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين والملائكة والمقربين والعالين وإلى عباد الله الصالحين من أهل السماوات وأهل الأرضين خاصة الروح الغضب الغوث والأغطاب والأوتاد والأفراد والبدل والنجب والنقب والملاماتية رجال الغيب أجمع يا ربي أسمع خاص صاحب الزمان المهدي المنتظر عليه السلام والخضر عليه السلام ويس الغرني عليه السلام سيدنا أبو بكر الصديق, عمر الفاروق, عثمان بن عفان يا كريم, علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه وارضاه يا أرحم الراحمين, وإلى سائر عبادك الصالحين من التابعين وتابع التابعين, خاصة يا رب العالمين, يا رب العالمين سيدنا إبراهيم بن أتلم, سفيان الثوري, ذنون المصري, رابع العدوية, عمر الفارد برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين, اغفر لهم جميعا وارحمهم برحمتك يا كريم, والحمد والعباس, عبد الله بن عباس, عبد الله بن عمر الخطاب, عبد الله بن مسعود, والله بن عمر العاص يا رب العالمين, وأنس بن مالك يا أرحم الراحمين, وتميم الداري برحمتك يا كريم, أبي سعيد الخضري برحمتك يا كريم, وسائر الصحابة وكل من حدثوا عن رسول الله, كل من فسروا كتاب الله برحمتك يا الله يا الله يا الله, أسألك للحسن البصري والجنيد والكرخي وبيزيد البسطامي وحدين العربي والإمام الغزالي وحسن الجباوي حاطم الطائي وثالث لزمانهم هذا الرفاعي الكبير والششتي والسهري وردي والنقشبندي برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين, أحمد بن إدريس رضي الله عنه ورضاه, أحمد التجاني, أحمد الرحيم اليمن البرعي برحمتك أحمد الراحمين, سيد الدردير, سيد الصعوي, سيد الحبني, سيد سمان, الشيخ الطيب والدبشير والقوش والدزين, شيخ المشيخ غريب الله, سيدي وأستاذي والدي حفاتي غريب الله رضي الله عنه ورضاه, الشيخ حسن يا كريم, ارفع مقامه وعلياته, سيد المشايخ والأولياء والصالحين, كل من حضرنا في هذا المكان من ملك وإنس وجان, خاصة يا ربنا لصاحب مفاتيح من المفاتيح وصاحب أبو الفرج, يا رب اغفر لهم وارحمهم وعلم مغاماتهم في الجنة, كل من سألنا الدعاء, كل من حضرنا في هذا المكان, صلي وسلم على سيدنا محمد, الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله, صلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا نبي الله, صلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا حبيب الله, صلاة والسلام عليك يا إمام المرسلين, صلاة والسلام عليك يا خاتم النبيين, صلاة والسلام عليك يا شفيع المذنبين, ألف صلاة وألف سلام عليك وعلى آل بيتك أجمعين, سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون, وسلام على المرسلين, والحمد لله رب العالمين, الفاتحة, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, الحمد لله رب العالمين, الرحمن الرحيم, مالك يوم الدين, إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم, صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين, آمين. The last word I will say, please, let us think of this awesome project, and please, yes, you can do this for yourself, but anybody else who can do, don't keep it to yourself, ask them to do. Yes, inshallah.
When you were talking, I had a lot of thoughts and questions in my head, but actually just two quick points that I wanted to bring up. One is, neither are a question, but the first subject was one of my great teachers, Ustaz Abdul Khad. Some of you may know him, or some of you may haven't heard the name. He passed away 5 days ago.
Rahmatullah Abdul Ghadir man.
Who is called Abdul Khad, who is Masri.
Okay.
He passed away at the age of 78. Allahum. And for those of you who didn't know him, he came to this country very young. He suffered a huge number of diseases: kidney failure, bowel cancer, heart failure,
Allahum.
And so many things. Subhanallah. But he led such a fantastic life in the sense that he founded one of the biggest Arabic communities for teaching Arabic and Islam, beginning at in Belgrave Square, the Arabic Chamber of Commerce.
Yes, yes, yes.
And then continuing, the school still continues to
yes.
this
day. You say the school for Arabic. Yeah,
for
yeah.
Arabic, yeah. He passed away 5 days ago, on the 22nd of February, and instead of all the questions that I wanted to ask, the only thing that really came to my mind was him to mention. So I would just like to ask, inshallah, if everyone could make dua for
him. We'll make dua for him.
Ustaz Abdul Khad,
inshallah.
He passed away 5 days ago, inshallah. May Allah grant
you. We will make dua for him now. And regarding this issue, and this is a very good thing for a teacher who taught you, because the best thing you can prepare a teacher is to pray for them. And therefore, there is a misconception, misunderstanding. When somebody passes away, some people say, yani we can just make a dua for them, that's it. And some people say, this dua can only be accepted for them from their own children. Quoting a verse from the Quran and a hadith from Rasulullah. The verse they say, Allah said in the Quran, وَأَلَّيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى. The person, once they pass away, they can achieve nothing because their book is closed, only that which they have done when they are alive. That's true. Once you die, you can't do anything for yourself. And the other one, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, in which he says, إِذَا مَاتَ ابْنُ آدَمْ انْقَطَ عَمَلَهُ إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ. When the son of Adam, daughter of Adam, passes away, his work is stopped only from three. A righteous child they leave behind that prays for them. A charity that is going to be continuous, as long as it's continuing, it's going to bring them good deeds written in their books. A knowledge that they left behind is going to benefit them. Subhanallah, subhanallah. It is true to the extent the verse and the hadith say that in qata'a amaluhu, your work as the person who passed away, you cannot do anymore unless those three things are there. But he did not say in qata'a amal al-akhirin lahu. The Prophet ﷺ did not say others, if they want to do on your behalf, it's going to be stopped. No, he didn't say that. As long as he did not say that, anybody can do. Who explained this properly? Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawzi, the student of Ibn Taymiyyah. He says, anybody else can pray for them, can read Quran for them, can make Umrah for them, can be in charity for them, can do a sadaqah, anybody, not their own children. If the student does not pray for their teacher, who else can pray? That's why the name they mentioned, all of them. I pray for all the scholars that I think I benefited from in my chain of learning. I start from the Prophet ﷺ. Allah. In fact, I pray for the Malaika. Okay? This is my dua. People ask me, Wallahi al-Azim, Allah is my witness. I do this all the time. I was doing it in my circle in Central Mosque in the 80s, 81, 82. And there is an aerospace engineer from Malaysia. I haven't seen him for a long time. He's called Arif. He used to work for British Airways. One day he stopped me. He said to me on a Thursday, he said to me, always you read this dua. What's the benefit of this dua? He had that conception. What benefit will get them? And I read Fatih for them at the end. So I told him. So he went home. In the same night, he read the dua. On Friday, he came to Central Mosque. He came running looking after me. I said to him, what's wrong? He said, I read the dua and I saw in my dream the Prophet ﷺ sitting with all the companions. Because I said to them, I read for some of the companions. Alhamdulillah. So this is good from you to ask us to read. There is a group going around saying, when somebody dies, you don't need to make a khatam of Quran for them. This is bid'ah. Reading Quran is bid'ah. Astaghfirullah.
One of the shaykhs, he came to me. He said to me, Omar, my sheikh came to me. What gift you gave him? I said to him, I pray for him.
Mm.
Because he said to me, tell Omar, I got his gift.
Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar.
I was praying for his sheikh. Because he introduced me. By Barzakh, I haven't seen his sheikh. Then I continued praying for his sheikh. His sheikh came to him. He said to him, listen, tell Omar, I got his gift. Then he came to me, Omar, sheikh said to me this. Yes.
Of course. This goes without... There is many stories from the time of Prophet ﷺ whereby people died and people pray for them and they come in the dream and they tell. It happened to me many times. I pray for people and people come.
Yes.
And do this to you. So pray for people who pass away and will make dua for your sheikh and read for him. Read Quran for him. And there is very, very important issue today. I really feel if we don't stick to it, we're going to diminish your benefit in the future. My father prayed for his father. His father prayed for the father. My father told me, I'm praying for my father. I'm reading Quran for him. I'm doing Hajj. When I go to Ramadan to Saudi Arabia, I make a Umrah for my father. I make a Umrah for my mother because they passed away. If I don't teach this to my children, what hope do I have? If this is me, and I'm double your age, what about you? Born in England, raised in England. If you don't teach your children to do this, when you die, وَمَا بَكَدْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّمَاءُ وَالْأَرْضِ neither the heaven nor the earth will cry over you. So you need to teach your children to do this. And do it. If anybody stands and says to you, this is bid'ah, tell me, give me one evidence that the Prophet said, don't do it. Anything in Islam to say don't do, they must be a don't. If there is no don't, it's mubah. You can't do it. So may Allah give tawfiq to your sheikh. I know of the man. And I'm grateful that you remind me because I didn't know he passed away. May Allah bless him because I know the school. And I know from the beginning the people who used to be behind it, many of them passed away. Like Dr. Ahmed, rahmatullah alayh, and many others. May Allah bless his soul because he established one of the very beautiful Islamic school for children to remain as Muslims. Although they were teaching Arabic language, but behind it, they were camouflaging it with Islam. Absolutely. And manners and akhlaq. And most of the Egyptian kids who went there and others benefited from it. So we read Surah Al-Ikhlas for him, inshallah.
Ameen, Ya Rabbi.
For Rasulullah said, whoever reads Surah Al-Ikhlas 3 times, as if you read the whole Quran, may Allah put it in his book for him. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد يا واحد يا أحد يا واحد يا أحد يا واحد يا أحد يا فرد يا صمد يا من لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد نسألك اللهم باسمك العظيم أن تصلي وسلم على نبيك الكريم وآله وسلم تسليما وأن توصف ما قرأنا ونرمى تلونا هدية واصلة بعد القبول منك لروح المرحوم عبد القادر يا كريم. اللهم يا ربنا إنه قد بدأ عمل خير فبارك له في هذا العمل واجعل له فيه خيرا كثيرا وأجرا وفيرا يا كريم. ربنا إن كان محسنا فزد في إحسانه وإن كان مسيئا فتجاوز عن سيئاته يا كريم. ربنا انزله منزلا طيبا وانزله منزلا مباركا واحشره مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين. We ask Allah to write this Surah Al-Ikhlas in his book and to give him in abundance and to raise him to the highest of this place in Jannah. Anybody who passed away today in the Muslim world and over the world, Ya Rabbal Alameen, may Allah give them the same tawfiq and give them a high place in Jannah. And if we reach the position that they have reached, may Allah forgive our sins and exchange all our bad deeds to good deeds and give us a high place in Jannah, Ya Kareem. Our fathers and grandfathers, uncles and aunties, and all our relatives, our teachers, and those whom we have wronged in this world, Ya Kareem. May you give them tawfiq for dunya wal akhirah and write Surah Al-Ikhlas in their books, Ya Kareem. Salli wa sallim ala Ahmad al-Nabi al-Amin wa alihi wa sallim. Ana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun ala al-mursaleen. Wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Al-Fatiha. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahmanirrahim. Maliki yawmiddin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'een. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqeem. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. جزاكم الله خير.